reports and comments, selectmen's liaison reports and comments first up, followed by public comment and the town manager's report. We then will, we have an amplified sound permit application before the board. Also, we have a pledge of license request from Busa Liquors. Then we have some personnel, and those will be taken up at 7:20, 7:30 respectively. Personnel and appointments to various and sundry subcommittees. Our volunteer appointment subcommittee has been busy up to the moment of this calling to order of this meeting, finding some folks to fill these roles. At 7:40, we'll do those appointments. At about 8 p.m., we will discuss the intermunicipal agreement with Wakefield for post-program special education students. Post-program for special education students, sorry. At 8:15, we will preview the fall town meeting articles with a focus on financial items. At 8:45, I will lead a discussion on the Board of Selectmen's communication policies. And we will then conduct the annual town manager evaluation at 9 p.m. We will approve minutes of the August 11th meeting and then follow at about 9:30 with an executive session to discuss strategy with respect to litigation regarding Sutton Brook. So with that, I will start with selectmen's liaison reports and comments. John?
You know what? If you could start at the other end, that would be better. I
nailed you a couple times there, Barry.
Oh, yeah. I didn't realize that the phone rings on the iPad too.
It happens.
The one thing that I do had since the last meeting is I've been in contact with the folks at, they've been in contact with me, the Climate Advisory Committee, and Dan, they've been in touch with you as well about seeking our support for certain legislation that's at the State House right now involving gas leaks. There's a couple of different bills in front of the legislature. Both have been endorsed and sponsored by our state rep, Mr. Dwyer, and state senator, Mr. Lewis, about just reporting gas leaks and also some consumer pricing issues along with that. So the senator and the rep are seeking our support of the legislation. So I think at some point the Climate Advisory Board wants to come and make a presentation and to seek our support for that.
One of the things I want to take up later, Barry, under communication policy is sort of a generic overarching framework of how we deal with requests like this. Clearly, we don't want to ever weigh in, but we don't want to be responding to every single bill before the general court.
No, our bandwidth is limited. On the other hand, there are certain things that go on outside.
And this may well fall into that category.
What goes on outside and other government bodies that we need to at least address. So.
Very good.
Other than that, I think it's been quiet summer.
Kevin.
Yep, as you mentioned earlier, both John Halsey and myself have met twice, once last Tuesday and then just half an hour ago for the Volunteer Appointment Subcommittee. And so we have several appointments that are going to be coming for this full board tonight. We also have one person who is coming in for a second time before the full board. We felt that there was further that the board may want to weigh in, other than just John and myself, in a full discussion about an appointment.
Is that because there's more than one person contesting for this?
No, it's this is a case where John and I discussed this at length during the Volunteer Appointment Subcommittee meeting. In regards to, we have a person who's very much a capable, willing, and where we both feel a good fit from his background standpoint for the committee. We do have some reservation with the amount of time that he may or may not have to recuse himself because he's actively working in the community now, as well as knows a lot of people that are actively working that would be coming before that committee. So we felt that maybe a full board discussion might be a better route to go.
What's that person's
gentleman?
Name?
That is Al Couliard, who's going to come in at 7:40 tonight. So I think that's why we do have conservation first up. It is for the Conservation Commission.
Mm-hmm.
But other than that, it has been a slow summer.
How about you, John?
I've been several times actually at both the Recreation Committee and the Subcommittee for Birch Meadow. I think it's important to report that we do have the Recreation Committee now has all the results of the surveys that have been going on. I think it's very important for us to point out something that is, I guess it's not surprising to me, but I think in general it's a surprising fact that of all the families, the households in Reading that were asked to participate in the survey about Birch Meadow, over 6%, which is a stunning number. They normally expect 1 to 2%. 6% of the total resident base, family base in Reading, responded to how they use Birch Meadow. And I think that the plan is that they will come in front of us. I mean, it was very eye-opening. The there are, you know, a couple of other things that so the Birch Meadow committee, the subcommittee, is done a lot of work over the course of the last couple of months. I think that's very important as we approach the time that we'll be needing to have a, I think we need to have a public hearing around the lights that are going to be going in.
Is it going to be on the generic master plan or just the lights?
No. I think that the public hearing that we're going to need to have is about the lights, isn't it?
My understanding is that the public hearing, let me back up a little. At November town meeting, under the first article reports, someone, maybe me, is going to stand up and give a brief update of the Birch Meadow process. Obviously, I can't do a very good job now because I don't know.
Right.
Yeah. With some of the voting things. So based on what the survey has discovered, we want to get town meeting's appetite for some of the choices.
Right.
When the board wants to have a official public hearing to discuss those choices, I don't know, but probably after November.
But we're talking about the generic master plan there, correct?
Yes, that's what
we're talking about. Two different things.
I'm talking about everything other than lights.
Okay,
lights
how about
already
the lights?
Have been de- well, what? Lights have been decided.
Yes. But weren't we going to have another follow-up meeting?
I hadn't anticipated a public hearing, but it's up to how the neighborhood meetings have gone. I had heard pretty well.
They have. Yeah. There are one or two people that are, you know, not particularly in favor of it. But in general, I mean, we did have a posted Board of Selectmen's meeting at Birch Meadow.
Yep.
And at that time, I think there were about 30-plus residents that attended.
Yeah, that's all right.
At that time, and this is kind of tied to this whole liaison report, really. I mean, there were questions. I think there was a lot of interest in the fact that we have previously talked about doing some things around parking mitigation, which I think, you know, was probably the biggest issue of the majority of those assembled. A couple of people just not interested in having a change, but, you know, in general, those meetings have gone very well. I know at the last, unfortunately, at the last Recreation Committee meeting, it actually couldn't come to order because of a quorum issue. Okay, which was unfortunate, but I do want to talk about, they heard a couple of things that were going on, and there was more discussion not only about the Birch Meadow development project, but also about the lights. Some very favorable, others, you know, there are a couple of people who just really don't think it's a great idea, but in general, I think that there seems to be as long as certain issues, especially around parking and noise and time, you know, those things.
Now you're hitting it, I think. My suggestion at the beginning was that we either the rec committee, probably the rec committee, devise an operational plan.
Right.
Hold a hearing with that as the subject. And then after that hearing, modify and approve it. I think that would...
It's less about the lights and more about the operational plan.
And that would include the lights and the effects from the lights.
Let me ask you a question.
Ancillary...
we've talked at the staff level, public safety and planning especially, and kicked around a lot of ideas that we think, regardless of anything else you do, should be done.
Right.
Now, is that part of this operational plan, or do you want to just do that on its own schedule? Because either's fine with me.
What do you think? Part of the operational plan? Just they've been kicking around general ideas?
Yeah, I think that it's less about the project, and it's more about how does it get, you know, where's the impact, and how do are we attentive to the impact?
Honestly, most of the comments we're hearing, it's not about the lights per se, it's about the process and about existing conditions, if you will.
I think it is tied to the operational plan. You know, how late is it going to be open?
Yeah. Right.
Who's coming, where are they parking, you know?
So that gives you something to finish.
Is there amplified sound or not amplified sound?
Right.
Of course. But of course, you know, there's no proposals in the, in any of the operational plans about altering the amplified sound discussions. I mean, that, I believe, continues to, you know, be the way that it is. And so, for example, there were, to kind of wrap up this liaison report, there were a couple of proposals that were brought in front of recreation. One was for an amplified sound permit by a young man. And I wish he was here today, and I wish that he could have finalized his plan in front of the recreation committee. But his name is Ben Minnie. And I'm gonna say Ben is about 10 years old, maybe he's 11. Ben is quite the musician, very actively involved with his own band. And he proposes a not-for-profit charitable concert in the park, at Memorial Park. And he did a beautiful job of presenting his plan. He has three charities involved. One is a national charity, two are local, including the food pantry. He's looking to put on a concert in the park, and he was there applying for a sound permit, which I thought was highly appropriate. It will be kind of a 4 to 7 o'clock on a, I believe on a Saturday night is his plan, in Memorial Park. And I think it's gonna be in late September. Now, when that gets finalized, which I think will happen tonight, Recreation, I notice, is meeting, I think it's very important for us to maybe even invite him to our next selectman's meeting. I think you'll be very impressed with his presentation and his plan. And he kind of went right through the amplified sound process just the way that it was supposed to go on. And Ben, I think, you know, if I was hiring somebody tomorrow, I'd be hiring Ben.
As you say that, it just triggered my my memory of a friend tagging me in this on Facebook in this Ben's post.
Yeah,
just pulling it up.
Yeah,
to
I mean, it's I tell you something. It's very heartwarming when we see our young people, you know, kind of step into the what they need to do through the government process to do something, you know. And so I wanted to mention Ben, you know, in this public setting, and I want to plug his concert. I'm assuming he's going to, the general sense of the Recreation Committee was they were interested in approving his sound permit, but they didn't have a quorum at the time. So I'm going to encourage, if that's all a go for the end of this month, that you guys, we all may want to invite him in to make his presentation. I think you'll find it.
Sure.
You know, something that'll be that we'll enjoy, number one, and that will be good for his kind of donative intent, you know. So, and then the apparently the Lions Club has an interesting proposition tied to they want to put together a dog walking event out near the
it's on Facebook.
Based at Wood End School. And they need an amplified sound permit. That's why they were in front of recreation. I think it's kind of a good idea. We'll see how that comes up, and there'll be more information as that's approved.
Are they going to play the singing dogs singing Christmas tunes?
No, actually, it's you know, it's apparently something that's been done in many other towns with, you know, as a nonprofit idea to raise money for the Lions, who are, of course, as we know, very involved in a lot of different charitable events here in town, including the Friends and Family Day that they sponsor and run. So those are the kinds of things that have been popping up in front of recreation. There's a lot going on over there. So that kind of wraps me up on that report. But I think we should hear more from Ben. Ben Minnie, who lives on Bachelor Road, and his plans for a concert in the park at Memorial Park.
Ben's Big Benefit.
Excellent.
Ben's Big Benefit Music Show.
Okay, on my part, the Bylaw Committee, as many may know or you may not know, is one of the standing committees at town meeting. We just, the Bylaw Appointment Committee, which is the moderator, myself as chair of the Board of Selectmen, and the chair of the Bylaw Committee, Steve Crook, just met and appointed a very energetic young gentleman named Christopher O'Donohue to serve on the bylaw committee for a 3-year term. Chris is a lifelong Reading resident, young man, very energetic, former Boy Scout, and we wish him well. Okay, I was contacted via email by a new business in town that they're going to be on our next agenda, but I just want to give you a heads up. Lori Haverty and Tiffany Freitas, I think that's pronounced, they run a it's a fitness company called Tread LLC, and they're looking to open at 5 a.m. They just missed the cutoff to be at our meeting tonight. Barry already mentioned the gas leak bills. We'll get into that more a little bit later in terms of policy for addressing things like this, and then the substance will come up in a subsequent meeting. And let's see. Second water meters is sort of still a lingering issue, Bob. I keep getting occasional email contacts about that. It might be worth sometime in the fall to put a short discussion item, refreshing the board on how sewer billing to the town happens versus sewer billing to the residents, and why this is or is not a good policy based on that. Very good. I think that's all I have. So with that, I'll ask for public comment from anyone here who wishes to comment on any item not on the agenda. Okay, hearing none, Bob.
Thank you. Behind me you see an approval, a limited approval, if you will, from the Attorney General on our proposed general bylaw change to add associate members. So it becomes effective once it's published in the newspaper a couple times by the town clerk, so it's not yet. But once it is effective, and it could be at the end of the week, the town clerk will advise all boards of this change. The Attorney General did not approve associate members for either ZBA or CPDC, saying that those must go through a zoning bylaw. So on the November town meeting, town council has drafted a new zoning bylaw, as if we didn't have enough of them, to just do this one purpose. So I previewed that with CPDC. Mm-hmm. I'll go in front of them on the 14th and do the same, and they have agreed to sponsor the article, and I assume they'll support the article. Interestingly, the only real twist that was unexpected is CPDC will only be allowed to have one associate member because of some case law and state law, whereas ZBA will be allowed to have two.
Okay.
And I think I mentioned that to the VASC because there was a possibility of you appointing a second associate member.
Was there any objection to having the CPDC member be able to stand in the quorum?
Not as long as there's only one of them, one formal associate member. Yeah. The language that council has prepared is identical to the general bylaw, except it's a zoning bylaw, and it's very specific to each of these boards.
Okay.
So same voting rights and so forth.
So
I did want everyone to know in the volunteer community, those of that have been sort of tentatively appointed as associate members will hear from the town clerk, need to come in and be sworn in, and off they go.
Now, how are we handling training for the board chairs, vice chairs, as to how this is all supposed to operate?
Yeah, that's an excellent question, and that's something that Matt's been working with the town clerk on.
Okay.
We're going to try to have a chair, vice chair meeting sometime. We had to wait till the summer. We're thinking October. The September's a little too soon to tell people to get calendars. So we're thinking of middle to late October. Once I get a date, I'll certainly let you know. I also wanted to update the board. I'll spend a little time later on one of the issues in detail, but we've been working pretty extensively with the superintendent and the school department over the summer on a variety of issues. You'll see later an extensive discussion on the facilities department and the proposed changes, which have been previewed with the school committee and have already in part taken effect. I'll leave it there because we are going to go over it in some detail. We have also discussed HR and as to whether we should consolidate, whether we should share, whether we should move people around. And John and I both feel that our current HR folks are great. We need them physically in the location where they are because we're in their offices a little too often. And we agreed that we want to ask FinCom and then town meeting ultimately to approve a third HR person in the budget to be shared. So they would have an office here and an office in the school department and be about 50-50 depending on the season and so forth. Probably a little busier at schools in August and a little busier in the town closer to January. But it would be an HR generalist. It would be someone who could step in and do maybe 80% of the job of the HR director if they were out, whether it's for an extended period of time or even just a week. It's the one area in the budget, in the operating budget, that we both felt most desperately understaffed. HR, as anyone in business knows, HR is just becoming more complicated all the time legally. And we just don't want to drop the ball. In technology, their technology, their network administrator resigned and has left. So we've actually appointed Kevin as their unofficial network administrator for a period of time till they can get back on their feet. They're in excellent shape for the opening of schools. Kevin has spent the majority of the last 2 weeks working just in the school department to accomplish that. You know, those of you who have met him that know he's excellent. John has agreed that Kevin will be the driving force, looking at resumes and scoping out, screening out the next candidate. We also talked about whether we should consolidate or combine that. And you know, in terms of the technicians, it doesn't make sense because what the schools do and what the town does is so different in terms of how to use technology. But in terms of the network, it's something that John, you know, had some discussions with me and was open-minded. But at the end of the day, we felt that both sides' interests were best served by having redundancy and having two good people. And what's the difference where they worked? You know, one network administrator ago had a really good relationship with Kevin for many, many years. The last one, not so good, not so communicative.
Mm-hmm.
And we just need to open that line of communication. You're going to also see a proposal at November town meeting for possibly up to $100,000 of some technology expenses, again, to be shared. You know, we're looking at reducing some or all vulnerability, essentially. So I think technology is best solved by having two good people that can back each other up as needed. And we also have a relationship with the light department in that sense. In terms of what the selectmen asked me to look at, the only unturned stone, as it were, is finance. And I think the change that you'll see later tonight in facilities should ease the burden of you know, work on the school department. And I think that's work in progress as to how they best want to solve it. But I will say that there's not a huge amount of overlap between the finance that goes on in the school department and the finance that goes on in the town hall. It's just very different. The person who is most facile with both parts is Sharon, clearly. You know, she works with Martha extensively. She worked with Mary before.
Mm-hmm.
So Sharon is good backup for the schools, as it were. But I think we've you know, pretty much mastered the discussion. I think facilities is the only real, if you will, eye-opening change. And interestingly, although it's optically a big change, operationally it's no change at all.
Mm-hmm.
Joe Huggins was jointly named by John and I as the acting facilities director. And as you'll say later, we're proposing to move a significant amount of the money from the school department to the town departments. And the school committee is very supportive of this. It'll be a joint relationship, a mutual relationship. We'll ask school committee and selectmen to jointly vote on budgets during the budget process. And again, from an operating standpoint, it'll be business as always.
Good. Bob, this is all very good news, and I think it's fulfilling promises that I made and the chair of the school committee made before town meeting that we would work and to have common cause in many of these areas. So thanks very much for that groundbreaking work.
I'll say the leadership of both the school committee and selectmen
and
worked very
Superintendent
diligently
Doherty.
And the superintendent.
Mm-hmm.
Did a nice job. We laid everything on the table and had some very good discussions.
Great. Right. Good to hear. Your timing is impeccable. We have now arrived at the amplified sound permit discussion. Mr. McFadden, would you like to come up?
Thank you. This is my yearly visit.
If you weren't quite so successful, they wouldn't have to see you every year.
Yeah.
Thank you. This is our fourth year, Saturday Night Lights. That we'll be running the flag football on Saturday night. It's been unbelievable, the success of it this year. We thought last year 560 kids was a lot. We're around 700.
Wait, how many kids are in town?
It's something like we have like 55% of the whole student body, which is crazy. And I think one of the major reasons we tried to do is really make it a community event, a carnival. Like this Saturday when we start up, you know, we'll have the bouncy house there for the kids. You know, the DJ, if you guys approve it, will obviously be playing, and the high high school teams down there, the football team, and some of the kids that play non-football are down there, from officiating to coaching. And the exciting part is, you know, it's very hard for high school kids to get jobs. We're going to hire around 40 high school kids to get them employment, which unfortunately have a waiting list. You know, people just, you know, the kids are looking to do anything they can. You know, we've expanded the program in terms of what we're offering. Like this year, for instance, we have all the kids, supposed to be a secret, but who knows how many people are watching the RCK now. All the kids are getting like uniform socks. So the kids will be excited. We went with them to camouflage, which, you know, in the baseball world is kind of like the newest trend,
right,
for the shirts. If you want to see all of them, feel free to stop by my house. My whole game room is overtaken with bags of shirts. One of the other things that we've done this year is a lot of businesses, of trying to support the businesses, where each night we're trying to set it up. Like, for instance, Chili's is going to have a night where every kid in the program gets to have dinner for free, which is, you know, a nice thing to, you know, to be able to support the local businesses. And the other thing is, some of the newer businesses in towns, when we met with them, they're like, you have how many kids there? Like, they had no idea how big it was. I think the only thing that actually slowed us down a little bit, which I know it's been working on, is like the lights, because that's the question when we met with all the coaches. Oh, are the lights going to be up? I'm like, unless those poles are going up in 48 hours, I tend to doubt it. But, you know, hopefully maybe the end of October, we can maybe have the lights will be up by then. But if not, you know, certainly looking forward to it next year, because based on past history, we're going to continue to expand. As far as I know from the DJ, we've never had any issues, any complaints from the neighbors that I've been aware of. I know, you know, sometimes police officers will be on their bikes if it's a warm night or something. They'll come down there and we're like, is there a problem? They're like, no, we're just looking for where everybody is in town. because on average, we have about 2,500 to 3,000 people there during the course of the 4 hours.
Wow.
Of the program. So it's, knock on wood, been very successful.
How many nights is it?
We go 8 Saturdays. Let me rephrase that. We go 7 Saturdays, and then the band does a competition, like a fundraiser for them, on a Saturday night, and we're, I think it's the 24th of October, we'll go Sunday night instead. When we go on that one particular Sunday night, we shorten the practice time so that the kids are home by 8 o'clock at the very latest, and those are the middle school kids anyway, so usually they're up until 8 o'clock. In reference with, last year we gave the concession stand to the elementary schools. Each one had a different night, and combined, I believe they raised, the number we were told was over $2,000. This year, as of now, it's going to the volleyball team, and the three other nights, they have conflicts. You know, we're gonna reach out to the robotics team to see if it's something that they wanna do. We have our hands full. We're not into the pizza and water business right now. Some of the other things that we've done in the program to help some of the families is, in November, we get a very large discount. I think it's about 25% off everything over at Sports Authority. So a lot of people do their Christmas shopping using the discount where they're there. We're lucky enough this year to bring in Julian Edelman to do a clinic.
Wow.
Which was fascinating, because you see him around the field, and
he's high energy.
Yes, and well, his Porsche certainly was, that all the kids are surrounded trying to look at him. But the high school kids are down there helping out, and you know, we had all the high school kids do a picture with him, and he was smaller than every single one of them. Like, they were all like, oh my god, I can't believe it. So, but that, you know, it was a nice thrill for the kids to see, you know, I would argue the Super Bowl MVP, but. So we're, you know, we're trying to expand things more to give the kids opportunities and support the local businesses.
If I could just ask Carl, if the reason Carl's here, aside from just giving you an update, what are you doing? What are you proposing to do a little differently this year in terms of amplified sound?
This year, well, we don't have a map up there, but you know where between there's that road that's supposed to be for the fire department, I think, between
right.
the two
yeah.
of the turf
yeah.
fields.
Yeah.
Because we've grown and we're going out towards the softball field, we're actually shifting everything further back towards turf too. You guys kind of
mm-hmm.
with
yeah.
that area, so that it's not bleachers on the home side, well, the only side of the bleachers, is kind of like going to be almost like a barrier for, if you picture the, instead of the speakers being in front of the bleachers, they're going to be like kind of back to the side,
mm-hmm.
so that the bleachers will absorb it. In addition, we got some speakers that, the ones that are facing the game field only have a distance of 100 feet, which is technically it's right to the other side of the track. They say it's 100 feet, I don't know. But between the short, by us moving them somewhat behind the bleachers and the trees, if they hear anything, it would be, they'll probably hear more of the kids laughing and being silly.
And where are they going to be directed from behind the bleachers? Which direction, like out towards?
Well, we have to shoot, we'll shoot one towards stadium field.
Okay.
And then we have one that'll be going towards turf two. We actually have a third one that will run a cord and put it, you know, those the two base softball fields are the grass, the multi-purpose field. Like we'll have one shooting out to that area too.
Okay.
So, they'll be kind of daisy chain around.
Yes, Bob.
We have also not received any complaints since the program started. And the only reason I asked Carl to come in really is a change, so we're all aware there's now a change. I don't
not
see
one
any,
complaint.
No, I don't, and I don't see any reason we're going to have any complaints, but
well,
just
that's good.
Full disclosure.
Mm-hmm. Well, it was always a first, Bob.
Exactly. So,
but and I think one of the reasons you probably haven't had a complaint is half the town seems to be their kids are
exactly.
in the program.
Exactly.
So.
Yeah.
That's obviously a benefit.
What are the dates and the hours of that you're doing this?
We start this Saturday,
okay.
and we go every Saturday except for the 24th. The first group of kids at kindergarten and first grade starts in starts at 4 o'clock, and the last group finishes up around 8:50.
Okay.
And we have high school kids clean up, and for some reason on Saturday nights they clean up very quickly, so we usually out of there by 8:30. One of the things that I do want to mention is that this year we were able to go to two divisions for the young ladies in town. We have a K to two division and a 3 to 5, and those numbers are through the roof. It's interesting because some of the mothers are going to be coaching, so
cool.
they get a little feisty sometimes.
Carl, what's the cost of the program?
The recreation charge is $159.
And is there any... if a family has like 3 or 4 kids and there's some hardship, are there grants available?
We would never, ever, ever turn away a child for that. And honestly, the rule that Jimmy Murphy and I have is we don't even want to know. John Feudo and Jenna and
mm-hmm.
Sue,
yeah.
I
they
go,
work,
I don't even
want to
know. Automatic. Don't even ask. No, waste your time. It's automatic. Yes, and all that stuff.
Great.
It's a great program.
Thanks, Carl.
It really does. I mean, it so involves the community in such a festive way. It's great.
Yeah, hiring the high school kids is great.
Yeah,
yeah.
I mean, they're just, I mean, there's so many components of this
right.
program that are just, you know, so good for the community. So.
Yeah,
it's fun.
So well done.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for coming in.
See you at the first football game.
Do we gotta get a vote in?
I don't think, we didn't have a motion.
I don't
here,
think
do
you
mean?
Need to. I just wanted
I
to make sure you had the change.
Me.
He's already
yeah.
gotten permission.
Yeah, that
in the
typically
past.
Clears through recreation.
Exactly.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's administrative.
But I, you know, it's good that you came here. You
yeah.
know,
appreciate that.
Given that there's been some amplified sound questions in the past.
Yeah.
so.
Well, thank you for your time.
Sure.
Thanks,
Carl.
Carl.
Okay.
Thanks, Carl.
Next time on the agenda is the Busa Liquors Pledge of License. Gentlemen that are representing Busa, come forward and please introduce yourself.
Hey, Ron. Andrew Busa.
Hi.
Hey,
Bro. Hi. Nice to meet you. Okay. Could you explain to the board the idea of pledging a license? Is it a collateral issue with regard to a loan? This is a first for me, actually.
Yeah.
It's we're switching banks from TD Bank to Berkshire Bank, and
mm-hmm.
I believe we have a pledge with TD Bank, and
okay.
we're just redoing
Chip,
it
yeah.
with Berkshire.
Okay.
And
so
this is a common item, Bob, that is requested.
It's no, it's not that common, but
no.
Town Council said it was fine.
Okay.
You reviewed it.
So is this for, basically, is that for a loan? Is that for an operating line of credit?
It's a line of credit.
Sounds like, yeah.
And so essentially, the license is already pledged to TD?
Mm.
Correct.
I believe I've heard BUSA has an extremely good record regarding non-service of minors. And,
yes, they do.
Commend you folks for that.
And a very strong record of community involvement,
yes,
as
yeah.
well,
yes.
I might add. I know that from a very personal involvement. I know they've been very supportive of a lot of things in town.
Much appreciated.
So, I mean, I have a question. It's the first time I've ever seen it. So I know in the very unlikely event that, that your license gets seized for non-payment of a loan, what's the implication to
good
the town? So now, so my guess is that now the bank would own that license, and now then do we have to negotiate with the bank if they want to, because that's it's a commodity, so they can sell that liquor license, right? To recover
totally.
The proceeds of the loan.
But,
so
but you still need to
we,
approve.
We'd still
need
approve.
We'd have to approve.
Yeah.
So we'd be dealing with the bank
yeah.
rather than.
Yeah.
Right.
It's
right.
kind of why they're here today. I mean,
yeah.
they, really nothing can happen with a license that doesn't
exactly.
you know, find its way through here. You know, all roads ultimately with any change have to follow their way through here.
Okay.
Including if Target wants to start selling alcohol in Massachusetts, as they are doing in another state.
They are. They got a legal license in Wilmington.
Really?
Yeah.
Interesting.
That's interesting.
Well, so doesn't Starbucks want to sell beer?
Well, I hadn't heard that.
I'm not
yeah.
sure that's in their biz plan.
It is.
It is? Really?
It is.
Oh.
I've actually seen that.
I think they started out in a couple of West Coast.
Yes, I think in Washington State.
Yeah.
And
Amazon is now.
Groceries.
Yeah, they're in the wine business, right?
Yeah,
I think anything you want, like our delivery through Amazon.
Wow.
Seattle.
Yeah, I thought we still can't get that delivery here in Mass, though, correct?
I thought they lifted some of the restrictions.
I think that's been changed.
Has that been lifted?
At least
yeah.
for wine, I
wine
think.
Has
okay.
been
thanks
changed.
To former quarterback Drew Bledsoe.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
All right, any other questions from the board regarding the pledge of license?
No. Hey,
this is not a formal hearing, I guess, but if there are no other questions, could we have a motion?
Move the Board of Selectmen approve the pledge of license for Boosa's Reading Liquors, Inc., DBA Boosa's Reading Liquors to Berkshire Bank in the amount of $1,500,000.
Is that seconded?
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? The motion carries 4-0. Congratulations.
Thanks,
thank you. Thank you. Good luck.
Okay. Best of luck. Okay, we're now moving on to our, let's see, personnel and appointments. So I'm going to turn this over to the chair of the volunteer appointment subcommittee, Kevin Sexton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As I mentioned earlier, we had several appointments come before us over the last two Tuesdays, one of which we felt we wanted to bring before the full board. Al Collier is here tonight. How you doing?
The only one?
Yeah, the only one, sorry.
Come on up.
Yes, but come on up.
Kevin.
Makes you special. Al is seeking appointment to the Conservation Commission. John and I had discussed at length with Al in regards to the appointment for him, and we felt that it was probably in the interest of the board to have a full discussion in regards to the appointment. So for I think the two members that don't know Al, why don't you just give them a quick bio on, you know, your background and why you're wanted
yeah,
to become on
like
the Conservation Commission.
I'm a building contractor, been a contractor for 30 years. Been working in Reading here, owned property and been building houses here for 9 years. And recently been moving to Reading, get involved in most of the communities I live in, and I know the most about conservation. I've been preparing before that, working with botanists and engineers and conservation boards that whole time for 30 years, so I know quite a bit about it, so I just thought, you know, thought I could contribute.
Al, how many cases a year in Reading would appear before the CONSCOM from people doing business with you? Is there a large
currently
number?
Currently I have three projects
yeah.
in Reading. One involves conservation,
okay.
the other two don't.
How many in a year do you think?
Small. I'm a small-time contractor. I've always been, you know, three or four houses a year. I don't have any equipment or guys or anything.
All right, so if you were on the CONSCOM and an issue came before you, what would be your course of action?
Well, I'd have to, I'm assuming I'd have to abstain. I wouldn't
yes.
be able to act on anything
actually
that
recuse,
I was involved
yeah.
in any way. I don't have any issues with that.
Okay. That's a small number, though, you're saying.
Yeah, yeah, that's a small number. I also, I work in other communities, too. I work in Stoneham, and I'm working in Very mad, so I don't work exclusively.
Yeah, and just for clarity, Al, I mean, you know, you met with Kevin and I, and
yeah.
you're you're not the only person, you're the only person that's here, but it's not because we questioned you. It was because we really felt that a couple of things were true. One is that we felt that somebody with contracting experience would be a great addition to the Conservation Commission.
Yeah, absolutely.
And, but the other side of that was that because you, you know, by your own, you know, admission, are involved in Reading projects and so forth, we just thought it was really important for, rather than us just, you know, suggesting that you be approved for this position, we thought it was really important for the other selectmen to be able to, you know, bring up any issues that might be on their mind to discuss them with you directly rather than, you know, and that would, you know, in fact, kind of do away with the necessity to call you back in because if, you know, if Barry and Dan and John Arena was here, had questions, they could ask you directly, as we already have. So that's really kind of the issue going on here, so.
Just a couple of questions. Now, are there two openings on Conservation?
Yes, there are.
There's one term ending in 2017 and one full term 2018.
And is Mr. Coulier the only person applying?
Correct.
I thought there was a second ConsCom.
We had, it was a second option. Heather McLean came before us earlier tonight. Her first was the Human Relations Advisory Committee.
We actually had more than one where the ConsCom was their second.
Yes.
We lost one of those people to
to the bylaw.
To the bylaw committee.
Oh, heck, he was great. We were kind of fighting over him.
Well, I can't figure like why they wanted to do the bylaws over Conservation. So right now, I probably should
hurry, get sworn in.
Yeah. Of the current people that are on the Conservation Commission, would Mr. Coulier be the only contractor?
Yes.
Yeah.
I believe that's correct.
And have we had a contractor on the board before?
Don't know.
Don't know the answer to that.
Not in recent years, but I don't know.
But, you know, from having observed the proceedings of the committee closely over the last year and a half, an awful lot of, you know, contracting issues come up. There are a lot of contractors that appear before. So, you know, as Kevin and I talked about the fact that having someone involved that has that kind of expertise could be beneficial to the entire committee.
I see them get stuck all the time on trying to meet them.
I actually, I agree with that, Al. I mean, I've observed them closely, and they work hard all the time. But a lot of issues come up that are construction-related, and it struck me that having somebody from that industry would make a lot of sense to have that kind of a resource. Mm-hmm. And the only question really is, I mean, how often are you, and Dan just asked it, how often are you going to have to recuse yourself from
Yeah,
the
that was the really only reservation that I had as well. I think someone with your background and yourself is a great fit for the reasons that John just detailed. The other part of it, though, would be also not just how many times would you have to recuse yourself, which doesn't sound like it'd be a lot, but how many times would you'd have to recuse yourself in general? There's a lot of times you're going to be folks that other contractors that you know work with that are going to be coming before you. There could be a... you may have to recuse yourself from voting on something of those issues as well.
I don't know if that's true unless there's a direct business relationship or a familial relationship.
Yeah, that's the part I wanted to talk about.
Okay.
There's the conflict, which is reasonably clear. It's about as black as white as you can get.
Yeah.
And Al would clearly have to step out, as he said. But then there's this thing called the appearance of a conflict. And that's a much grayer area.
Yeah.
You know, as town council would say, the state has invented an ethics forum for just about everything. So, you know, should Al be successful, there are at least one and maybe two forms that we would ask Al to fill out with the town clerk.
Okay.
Just to go on record that I'm a contractor.
Yep.
Even though it's not my project that might be in front of ConsCom, there might be people I've dealt with in the past or may deal with in the future. Just so that's right out there and open.
Would you have any
those
objections?
Those forms actually keep you out of harm's way.
Exactly.
They're designed around that.
No problem with that, Al? Yeah.
Okay.
Al, are you familiar with the body of conservation bylaw? You're pretty familiar with it? Okay, and you feel you can impartially exercise your duties?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
And just I know the Conservation Committee meets a lot.
They do. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so, you know, the question I would have is, you know, contractor, when you get your busy season, you know, you're working. Would you, do you feel that you'd be able to make those meetings and?
Yeah.
It's not a meet, it's not like a.
I don't work till 7 o'clock at night, right?
Well, sometimes it's a lot of site visits, as we discussed as well, too, yeah.
Yeah, we talked about, they do a lot of the site visits on Sundays.
Sunday mornings.
Yeah.
Yeah, which is, you know, it's fine. They're quick, I've been at them before, a lot of times for me.
I don't think you're allowed to work on Sundays anyways, are you?
Can't bang a hammer, but, you know, like, once.
Quietly.
One of their longtime members, visited our committee meeting, to kind of, I guess as a point of interest in a, in, you know, the public process, but also, we seized that opportunity to have him talk about the Sunday morning visits and all those kinds of things, so Al would be the beneficiary of that information kind of on a firsthand basis from a longtime member, so.
I actually talked, Jamie called me on the phone.
Yeah, Jamie Mom was the person that was.
Somebody must have told him that I was applying for the Conservation Commission, he asked me some questions and.
Yeah.
Actually said that, you know, you're right, a lot of stuff comes up that we just don't know, cost wise and construction wise and, you know, it'd be good to have a.
Yeah, I concur with that analysis.
Jamie's a very ardent conservationist and if he's saying that about you, then I think that's, that counts for a lot.
Listen, everything that I get through that, everything that I have, you know, I've been doing this for 30 years, I don't bring things that aren't gonna be approved, I already, I know the rules just the same as they do, so. None of my stuff really is ever that controversial, everything's always been approved through this board and through every community I've worked in, so that's not an issue.
Unfortunately, with a lot of this stuff, it's not black and white where you can say, well, this isn't gonna be approved, this isn't, a lot of it's gray, a lot of it is sort of using common sense, so I think it's good having someone with the construction background and a contracting background on there because a lot of times I feel things that generally that might be at loggerheads could be easily negotiated and figured out with someone on the committee who has that experience, so I think it's a good.
Well, that's why I plan, I think I can help.
Yep.
Thank you very much.
We still have one more to fill though after this.
Yes, we do.
Yes, we do, yeah, so we're only vote for one of these positions tonight, okay.
And I think when we talked with you, there were two positions that were open, one expires in 17, one expires in 18.
I think I said 17.
I think you did say 17, as I recall, so, okay.
Great.
I don't have any other questions.
Any other questions? Thanks for the discussion, board, it was good.
Yeah, thanks for coming in, I appreciate it.
Thank you, Al.
Is there anybody else we need to interview here tonight, or do you guys want to just make a brief report on?
No, we can just make a brief report. So we had several positions come in, as you saw earlier. We actually had a couple more than were on the bill tonight, but after the ruling from Attorney General's Office on regards to the Zoning Board of Appeals and CPDC. Those will be taken up at a later date. So we have 8 appointments tonight.
Mm-hmm.
One of which we were able to fill, which was a very needed role, was that of constable. Richard Robbins, former police.
Lieutenant.
Yep.
Retired police lieutenant.
Many years.
Police lieutenant kind enough to fill that role, which is greatly needed. So that was certainly a big one. We have some for the Rec Committee, Climate Advisory Committee, Elder Services, Animal Control Appeals. We have both a full term and an associate for that one, as well as the Human Relations Advisory Committee.
And we'll still have a vacancy in the a Board of Selectmen designee vacancy for the Human Relations Advisory Committee. We do have one to fill the other role.
Correct.
But we're going to still be one short there, one still short in conservation. So.
And do we have any on that? Any more candidates?
We are recruiting.
Yes, we have none right now, but still recruiting both for conservation, as I know they could use
spread the word
as well,
and human rights
and the Human Relations Advisory Committee.
Yeah. Okay. Or human relations. I'm sorry.
So, would you like to offer a motion?
I shall. Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the recommendations of the Volunteer Appointment Subcommittee as follows. David Zeke to a position on the Climate Advisory Committee with a term expiring June 30th, 2017. Do you want to vote on these one at a time?
No, you can do them as a block.
Okay. Yeah. Emily Sisson to a position on the Recreation Committee with a term expiring June 30th, 2018. Brian Snell to a Mystic Valley Elder Services Board of Directors with a term expiring September 30th, 2018. Just a note for Brian, we actually, we just appointed him
right.
back in June. So this is, because the term was expiring, this is just a reappointment for that.
He filled a vacancy.
Right. Richard Robbins as constable with a term expiring June 30th, 2016. Richard Robbins also to the Animal Control Appeals Committee with a term expiring June 30th, 2018. Joyce Gould to an associate position on the Animal Controls Appeals Committee with a term expiring June 30th, 2016. Alec Couliard to the Conservation Commission with a term expiring June 30th, 2017. And Heather McLean to the Human Relations Advisory Committee with a term expiring June 30th, 2016.
Is that seconded?
Second.
Any discussion, amendments, or further? That being no discussion ensuing, all in favor? Opposed? Motion carries. All are appointed. Congratulations. Okay. Great. We're right on the time. Well, a little bit ahead of time here. Is everybody here that's going to be participating?
Yes.
No?
Okay. Well, welcome, Dr. Daugherty.
Welcome.
And your crew. Happy to discuss this this IMA agreement with Wakefield. Would you like to come up and just run us through the essentials of what's been agreed to?
Sure.
Do you want to come up or do you want to stay there?
Either way.
I can say if they.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah.
There is fine.
So just to give you a little bit of history and.
The board has a copy, by the way.
Great. Everyone knows Martha Seibert. She's
yes.
Hi.
Hi, Martha.
Operations. And Carolyn Wilson is our director of student services and really is the person that. Has been working with Wakefield on the ground level developing this program. Last year, late in the year, we received word that EMARC would no longer be providing services for our population of students that are post-high school.
Mm-hmm.
We're required under regulations to provide services for students that may be developmentally delayed up until the age of 22. So this program really is for students 18 to 22.
Okay.
And Carolyn can go into detail of what the actual program is about. We were in the process of developing our own in-house program when Wakefield approached us with an idea that would be a great match for this population for both the Wakefield and the Reading Public Schools. And so we were pursuing it all summer. We've gone up and down like a roller coaster ride on this in terms of the challenges and the space needs. And so we have now reached a point where we have an intermunicipal agreement, which is in front of you. I know that there's been a lot of conversations between both boards, Board of Selectmen, for both Wakefield and Reading, school committees, superintendents, director of finance and operations, the director of student services, and town managers. I do want to thank Bob. Bob has last week worked very closely with the town manager to get the final agreement, draft agreement in front of you nailed down so that we could have this discussion this evening. The program is temporarily going to be in Reading for the next 6 months. There was some delays in the facility development at Wakefield, but the permanent home of the program will be eventually in Wakefield.
Okay.
I do want to let Carolyn talk a little bit about the actual program and what is going to be happening during this program.
Sure.
So POST stands for Purposeful Opportunities for Successful Transition. So we're naming the program the POST Academy. The goal, as Dr. Daugherty mentioned, is to service our population of students who are 18 to 22 who have intellectual impairments, and we continue to need to work with them. So the program will provide both academic, vocational opportunities, community-based opportunities. Our goal is to have the students out and about in both the Reading and Wakefield communities, accessing recreational opportunities. We have employers who are willing to have internship sites so the students can be part of our community. We've also created a couple, we're toying with some ideas of internship opportunities right at Reading Memorial High School. So even when the students move to Wakefield, we could still host a site for internship. We've also, one of the pieces that a lot of families are looking for from school districts is looking at independent living skills. So as students transition into the adult world, what skills do they have to be independent in their, both their community, but also in a living environment? So we're working with an organization called Creative Living to provide an opportunity for students to do an overnight where we would do an assessment of their independent living skills. So we're really looking comprehensively at these students and supporting these families as these students transition to adult services. And a lot of our families are really excited about the prospect of their child, their young adult, being out and about in the community as much as possible. So we're moving away from a model where students might access, let's say, the field house, to saying, nope, they're going to go to the Y. Because as a young adult, you don't go back to your, you know, your high school. You go to the Y or you join a gym. So teaching students those skills of how to be community-based. So we're really excited about what the program has to offer our students.
The benefit of the two communities sharing resources is actually two or threefold. One is that you have some shared costs, which normally last year we spent well over $200,000 for this population of students. This year the cost is going to be $150,000.
And that was through EMAR?
Most of it was through EMAR, yes. And we also, it gives us the ability to bring back students who currently are in out-of-district placements back into our program, which will be a savings on the overall school department budget. Wakefield will be doing the same thing. It also provides opportunities down the road to tuition in students from other communities as well, because we see this as a very exciting opportunity that, that isn't done right now in a lot of communities for this population.
Just real quickly in regards to that, Dr. Dory, so it sounds like the what you're going to roll out is an improvement as well into the program that you've been currently working on.
Yes.
That's great.
That's true.
And we modeled it after North Andover and Andover have a similar model, and that's where we got the idea, and Wakefield had actually spent a lot of time with them discussing what their model was, how did they share costs, and I know Martha had an opportunity to speak with...
Yeah, Jim Mealy and I are friends through my professional organization. He's the assistant superintendent of finance in North Andover, so I contacted him. And they, their program is well into its fifth or sixth year, and they're doing very well. And they families love it. They enjoy it. Theirs is hosted in Andover, but North Andover shares half the cost. So it was very similar to the model that we were exploring with Wakefield, where the difference they have is they each provide their own staff, and the Jim was explaining to me that that adds challenges because you get two different collective bargaining agreements, people start at different times, and so we opted for the more simpler model where one district was going to do the hiring, and where it was going to be, it is going to be in Wakefield. That was the path that we chose.
So where will we house it in Reading? Because I know space is a challenge.
So we are temporarily using the faculty dining room that's off the cafeteria.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Which is an ideal location because it's right under the footbridge, so it's easy parking for the van that we've leased for the young adults, and they'll have access in and out of the building from there.
Teachers will eat their desk.
They have their own department areas. So
I don't mean to make light of it. I know how challenging the space is.
So this is a statutory program. This is not a new program.
We've always been servicing kids.
Yeah. Right.
Why did EMARC get out of the business?
There was a decrease in the need for the services in several districts that EMARC has been servicing.
Many districts are looking at developing their own programs and staffing their own programs because the idea is that we want to be community-based. We want to have more ownership of what we're doing so we can monitor it a little better versus contracting out such a huge amount.
That might almost be a sign of success that you're having such good luck mainstreaming these kids when they're younger, that there's less demand when they're 18 to 20. Is that a fair assessment?
Good. So how many kids, you know, traditionally has Reading sent to this program? I know you can never predict it, right? It's going to be, but I mean, like the last 3 years and maybe next year, what are you?
I don't know that I have the trends. This year, our numbers are that we have four definite students and we have two students currently that we're working with families to place in the program. So our high would be six.
And Wakefield, roughly the same?
They have seven students.
So I didn't get a chance to read this because I just got it tonight, but is the cost sharing on a per pupil So, I mean, if, you know, one, you know, this year we have four, they have seven, next year we can have seven, they can have four. How does that, how's the cost sharing gonna get done?
It's right now, it's gonna be a 50-50. And the reason for that is it gives us budget certainty when we're trying to budget long-term for this program, instead of worrying about population fluctuations.
That sounds like both are having economies at 50-50 anyway.
And we're also gonna be using their facility as well, correct? And now, is the delay because it's going to the new middle school in Wakefield?
No, the space is actually near the fire station on
Greenwood.
Greenwood.
Greenwood Fire Station.
It's behind it. It's a standalone building behind it. It's actually really, it's a wonderful space.
Yeah.
It's very large and
It's an office building back there, right?
No,
it's actually
not
a town
a
building.
Oh, it's a town building behind. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's
I think
a town
it's next
building,
to the fire
right.
station, more than.
So
right,
once the
right next.
Okay.
Once the program moves to Wakefield, though, then are the Reading kids are going to need transportation? Is that also
there's
included?
There's transportation for them now.
Yes, we already transport.
It's included. It's a different budget line, but it's something that's already been budgeted for the transportation.
Do you have any way of looking out 5-10 years to see how much participation there will be then? Do you have you made any estimates of that? How this program may grow, shrink, stay the same?
It's stayed pretty much around this number of students.
Yeah.
It may dip or it
yeah.
may go up slightly, but it's been around 4, 5, 6 okay. over the years. And it's sometimes it's unpredictable because you could have someone moving in
right.
to
sure.
town that would then require these services.
We had a student move
yeah,
in
like anybody
mid-year last year who required these services. So.
Yep.
I also noticed that in the agreement that if there are kids from other districts, not Wakefield, not Reading, that are tuitioned in, that those costs will come off the top.
Mm-hmm.
So that'll reduce. So the fact that EMARC sounded like it was the only game in town for a while,
mm-hmm.
from what you're saying,
mm-hmm.
are there kind of orphan communities out there that are looking for a program that, I mean, I'm just looking at this in the cost savings.
Yeah.
That obviously you want to fulfill the Wakefield Reading needs first
mm-hmm.
before you go out looking for other.
Mm-hmm.
But it sounds like there potentially could be other communities out there looking for that
we're
could potentially reduce these costs at the
town. We're aware of one other community that's approached Wakefield about, once it gets up and running, about potentially tuitioning in a couple of their students. Because again, as Dr. Doherty said, the fluctuation,
right.
it's hard to sustain something when you don't have a consistent enrollment.
I noticed that most of the financial safeguards are Wakefield's responsibility. Does Reading have any oversight into checking, you know, a little bit of audit responsibility there?
The agreement does call for an audit and
mm-hmm.
quarterly updates in terms of what they're spending, but there's really not, the expenses are pretty well lined out in terms of, you know, the van, the lease on the van,
mm-hmm.
some few office things, but other than the staff, there's not a lot of cost.
Okay.
I mean, one of the important things is that we're looking at this right now as a 1-year,
right.
you know, trial.
All right.
I think they also are looking at their costs, and some of these estimates may.
I thought it said 3 years. Am I wrong?
It's a 3-year IMA.
It's three, but we could opt out.
Oh, yeah.
At the end of the first
right.
year. I mean, we don't plan on doing that.
Mm-hmm.
But
you have to create this yourself.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean that. You know that. The need doesn't go away.
Right.
You know,
no.
it's just
yeah.
who's going to provide it and what's the best way to do it so that you have high quality and manageable costs.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and I think that from EMARC's standpoint, I've spent a lot of time off and on there. Their target market of client to serve is really the 22-year-old.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know, I mean, I think what they were doing there was trying to fill a need that, you know, was unmet. Although that wasn't really their driving, the force behind their mission was really when a person with these kind of challenges hits 22, it's kind of like, oh my God, where do you go? And so I think that's where EMARC's, you know, mission has been, you know, for all along. So I don't think it was like, I think they were trying to fill a need, and it sounds like more and more try to do it yourself, and or the collaborative idea I think is a great idea.
Yeah.
And as you know, we already have
sure.
collaboration with Wakefield for food service.
Right.
So
yeah.
It's in history.
Sure.
Other questions from the board? Yes, Bob?
Just my comment is, you know, we've worked with a lot of communities, even though we don't necessarily have agreements with them. One of the things that this, and we're also discussing another one with two other communities, has brought up is when you share a physical facility, that's a little bit of a different wrinkle on anything we've run into in the past. So, you know, it's dealt with in this agreement, and, you know, if we come up with the other one in the fall, you'll see it. But there's no boilerplate and there's no magic about an intermunicipal agreement. It just takes flexible, two sides that are flexible and willing to discuss things. You know, and when another community uses their building, I insisted that it's not half our building since we can't just take half. But these discussions need to happen because, you know, there's maintenance of a building, there's upkeep of a building. And traditionally, we've more shared the town hall staff or in the case of food services, the food services staff. As we get into other areas, you know, we just have to be open-minded, I guess I'll say.
Sure.
And Wakefield was certainly a very good partner in this from my perspective.
Very good. Any other questions from the board? Okay.
What do we need to do?
We need to approve the motion.
Motion
is before us, Mr. Secretary.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the intermunicipal agreement between Reading and Wakefield to share a special education program for youth ages 18 through 22.
Second?
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor? Opposed? The vote is 4-0. The motion carries.
Thank you very
right.
much.
Job well done.
Great job.
And I want to add a kudo to the great work that's been done in collaborative movement on the technology and other matters. Thank you very much.
You guys got a good night's sleep. School starts tomorrow.
We're aware. Yeah.
You've been holding on to that one for a while, weren't you?
Yeah, you were. All right. All right, we're on to our town meeting article preview, item 5D.
Thanks. I'll buzz through the outline of articles. It's not
okay.
very different from what
just
you've
in
seen.
Our,
this is in your packet. I just want to draw your attention primarily to, well, you know about the roadway acceptances. We do have 6 definitive roads.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much, Dan, for that petition.
Sure.
We got both our
petitions they did all the
in
work.
Today. Yeah. So 4 of these roads are old subdivisions, and 2 of them had previously gone through town meeting but never been completed. So town council suggested since they weren't subdivisions, they really have to be resident requests. So Dan was very helpful, and Karen Herrick was very helpful getting 2 petitions done in less than a week from the other 2 streets.
Excellent.
So we have 6 roads that'll appear. For zoning bylaws, you have the purpose, which is relatively short. Telecommunications, I'll probably change the name to that. It's got to be an enormously long bylaw, but it's actually not that complicated, but only town council can explain it to you. Aquifer Protection District, you've heard about.
Mm-hmm.
And then here's the new one that I had not previewed you previously because of the associate members.
Right.
That's a very short one. I have asked you for a couple of bylaw changes. One is removal for absence. This just relates to the change that was in the charter, and it cleans up a bylaw, you'll see quite simply. Residency requirement, I know we've discussed that in the past. The charter now allows it, but the bylaw forbids it, so I think it's a discussion the board should have as to...
Allows a non-resident?
Whether you want to allow a non-resident, and if you do, whether you want to have any conditions on how many non-residents on a given board, for instance. I have not seen it yet, but we will have an animal control bylaw. This is our animal control bylaw. It was not well liked by the Attorney General's office, I know. And lastly, the firearm bylaw that I know 2 of the members have worked on. So it's probably a 2, and depending if things get, you know, really discussed heavily, a 3-night town meeting. I'll focus next on the financial issues, and there is going to be a lot more finance discussed at a November town meeting than is typical.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all under the current year's budget and the capital plan.
Now, do those several of those things have to come before us before they end up as warrants?
Next meeting, I think it's on the 15th, you will actually be closing the warrant, so you'll see a text of all of those articles, 14 of them. So in that sense, yes. The specific details within an article, such as the financial details, you know, you don't necessarily approve. You might vote as a board to support or not, but you don't need them to close the warrant.
Right.
There's an enormous amount of action in the capital plan. is brought about by two things. One, we had obviously a pretty tough winter last year, and some of the DPW equipment is fairly beaten up. We didn't know it in time for April town meeting. If you think of the logistics, you would have had to know that in January and early February. We just didn't. So there was actually two significant pieces of equipment requested. I think we can afford one of them, and one of them will do in the next year. And I'm not going to take you through all these, but I spoke earlier about technology disaster recovery for town and schools. This completes work that was started maybe 5 years ago to have a fully redundant and fully backed up system on each location, high school and our data center. And this will really, I think, make us both sleep.
I want one of those $140,000 snowblowers. I really want one.
We could use one.
After last winter, yeah.
Well, so 1999, that means that's how old the one we're replacing is?
That's the one we're replacing, yeah. And we may not actually trade it in. We may keep it, but just...
I was going to say, the Farmer's Almanac is saying maybe having a backup this year is going to be a good idea.
I've heard that. And when this was first discussed a week or 10 days ago, I said, all right, go find out how many there are for sale. And the answer was 7. Then one of our neighbors bought 2 of them. I said, what are the chances we're going to get this, you know, after town meeting, be able to buy one? 50-50 at best.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we could wait till April and just buy it for the next season. But there's a chance that this could be helpful for this season, so I don't see any harm in bringing it forward.
That makes sense.
Phone project, we're doing the final leg of a phone project, and schools have 40,000. We're going to work on that piece too, so there's 2 pieces adding up to 100,000, and this will include the new library. And then you'll see a number of changes that the new facilities director has made. Some of it's just juggling around some priorities. And then in FY17, I do want to mention a couple things. Specifically, at the very bottom here, there's $350,000 for Killam Field. Last year in the capital plan, there was a couple hundred thousand put in to regrade the Killam Field and solve some of the drainage issues. We went out to bid once and failed based on price, redesigned the project to be smaller, and failed again. It's just a tough construction season. And so this 350 number is not only all the things they had planned to do, but after speaking to Principal Kathy Giles, the parking lot really needs significant paving work in the back. And this would not even accomplish all of that, but it's a good chunk. So we can combine Chapter 90 roadway money with this, and we can get the parking
lot. We'll try to put it out there one more time, and hopefully in a more favorable...
Well, if this is approved by town meeting again in April, May, we'll do it as fast as we can for the summer.
It's got to be ready.
It'll probably actually go out before town meeting technically approves it, and then be ready to execute.
Yeah.
So we have a good idea on price.
So basically, the Killam project was too small for people to be interested in. So we
have to combine other things
with it. Is that what's kind of?
That's a really good question. We redesigned it to then exclude the grading, the leveling of the field, because figuring that was the prohibitive part, and the bid still came in too high. There weren't a lot of bids. So was it too small of a job? I guess so, based on what other contractors are busy doing. I mean, you see them all over the place.
Well, yeah.
Working on big jobs.
The demand for their services is so high.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we have thought about and kicked around the idea of doing it with our staff. And if we fail again, we're going to have to explore that in more detail. But we just don't have extra people to be used like this, and we don't have all the right equipment. We'd have to go out and lease some of the equipment.
Yeah, I mentioned this to you that I questioned whether or not it was going to change anything when we took that grading out, because that significantly impacts the usability of that field, as a recreational spot. It's not a surprise to me that we came up dry again.
Yeah. And, you know, one of the driving forces is, in addition to recreation, it's very poor drainage.
Yes.
There's drainage work that needs to happen.
Well, it just floods.
Yeah.
It's there's never been any money put into it. I mean, dating back forever, it's just never been.
So this is a pretty big bite. $400,000 in November is about as big as it gets for capital. But this is a preliminary list. It's not final, but my guess is it's going to be in this neighborhood. And then next year, the $100,000 reduction is good, but I think this capital plan is still out of balance, and we'll have to trim some more just to get within the FinCom parameters.
What's the funding mechanism, debt or?
I'll get to that in the next article, because there's quite a lot, in addition to the capital, there's quite a lot of financial activity. So if you go to the pages that starts Article 5, which is behind me,
Okay.
We're able to decrease $85,000 from the employee benefits lines, I showed you a couple of them.
Mm-hmm.
There's that capital expense, 23,000 for all those pieces of equipment and changes. For FinCom reserves, and I could have asked Dr. Doherty this today, as a safeguard, the modular classroom project is having some challenges, certainly. By the time things go to print for town meeting, I don't think we'll know the exact cost of the project. So this is a safeguard against cost overruns. We'll plan to ask FinCom to put an extra town meeting to put an extra $150,000 in the FinCom reserve fund in case it's needed. On the floor of town meeting, I think we'll know the answer. We certainly should. And we can scrap this or we can modify it as needed. I'll tell you right now, based on what I heard this morning, there's no need for this. We still have tiny, tiny, tiny amount of contingency. But this is clearly the prudent way to go, because if we need money, there'll be no money.
We'll be paralyzed.
We'll be paralyzed.
If we don't do this.
And we can't very well potentially wipe out the FinCom reserve fund because we didn't do good planning. And even if we were to put in a significant amount of money, it doesn't mean it gets spent. It's just up to FinCom to then vote it as they need to. So this is what the schools thought was the most prudent course, which I certainly agree with.
Okay, and that's been discussed with the FinCom. They understand the ground
rules. It hasn't yet. No, they don't meet till another couple of weeks.
That's not free money for them. They know that. Okay.
Yes.
There's never free money for the FinCom.
I'll skip over. You're aware that there was some paying class money approved. We're still in discussion as to how to allocate all that, but that's a zero-sum game. But I will say, now we get into the facilities department and some suggested changes, and here's the first one shown by this little hashtag. We are suggesting to upgrade what is a vacant position called business analyst to be a procurement position, probably procurement agent, I'm not sure. When we're proposing to take over or take on additional facilities work, as I'll show you shortly, maybe I should show that now, a lot of the operations can be done by town staff, but not completely without any changes. We can't just take on all this work without some additional help. And let me just show you what I mean for the facilities department. This is a reasonably good picture.
We don't have this in our packet.
Yeah, I think it's in there somewhere. It's two pages. The first, which is this section right here, is the current situation of how our facilities department budgets look. There's a $3.17 million school department portion, and there's a $770,000-odd town buildings portion under the school department, but not voted as part of the school budget. So it's about a $4 million facilities budget right now. We're proposing in two parts, certainly to just do a lot of transfers to keep that same $4 million, but effectively make, if you will, three legs of the stool. The school department will end up with $1.2 million instead of $3 million, and this is school facilities issues that are directly related to only school buildings, maintenance and upkeep, so the custodians, for instance, and expenses and supplies. Same exact thing for this wing over here for town buildings. That's custodians and that's supplies only in town buildings. Everything else will be centralized under this new, if you will, town facilities department, and things like all the energy costs, all the capital, and the staffing, such as the director and some of the tradesmen, will come out of this budget right here. So if you will, it's a three-legged
stool. The
tradesmen
are going to be used interchangeably anywhere.
Right. So custodians, we don't share custodians
between
school and town.
What a common sense approach to this.
All the school custodians may work in other school buildings as needed, but they only do schools, same with the town. So they remain isolated, if you will, but everyone else is in one place and we share them just as we always have.
Yeah.
So that's the theory. And then we're going to ask town meeting for a couple of additions. The school committee a few years ago cut out the number two position, the assistant facilities director, and agree now that that's needed back in. So we'll ask to add that back in. And we're going to ask to hire a fourth town custodian. As it is right now, the three are overworked. And with the additional attention on and square footage of the library, I think it's a prudent thing to do right away. And our three custodians are reasonably close to approaching retirement age. And if they all walked out the door at the same time, we'd really be stuck up the creek, because the institutional knowledge they carry around is unbelievable. there's 40 years experience, 25, 30 years experience in the three of them. So they know how things work, and we need to hurry up and add a fourth person. So those are the only two additions. You know, there may be more in the future as we iron out the kinks.
Bob,
yeah.
What would the number two in facilities do? What would their job description be?
Still being worked out. Just to be clear, the number one, the facilities director, has already been, you know, appointed on an interim basis, Joe Huggins. He reports equally to the town manager and to the superintendent of schools, is evaluated for his performance by both with John and the lead. But all the other employees report to the facilities director, if you will, and that includes town custodians and school custodians, and are answerable to him. The exact duties will just have to be split up and defined by the facilities director. I imagine they've already worked on a job description, although I haven't seen it.
Well, not unlike what we've done with a, you know, a deputy chief and, you know.
You know, in the past, when there were three positions, I know what the duties were, and then when it was consolidated to two, you know, some things just didn't get done. And that's why you're seeing some capital requests and some moving around of capital plans. What you're not seeing is there's a lot of operational changes going on that can be absorbed with the right money, but just rearranged.
When you're in front of town meeting, Bob, how are you going to boil this down to the benefits, the writing of this plan are?
I think we're going to have to do that in a real simple PowerPoint without showing a lot of the bells and whistles of movement and just talk about operationally, not a lot is changing. You know, it's a big optical change. It's a big budget change. But town meeting is going to have to hear from the school committee and the superintendent that they're comfortable with it because they're the one that are transferring
right.
this out.
Maybe
and then they're going to have to. It will be, and
yeah.
they're going to have to be comfortable that we can take it on, that we can take on this work, because it is a fair amount of work coming our way.
Yes.
Some of it is just facilities related, and they will do it. But in terms of procurement and you know, contract oversight and budgeting, you know, other things, and HR, it's a lot of work.
Yeah.
And we'll have to, you know, convince them that we're capable of that.
But the value proposition of this approach is very powerful.
You know,
For what you spend.
Yeah, we've learned a lot in the last year, particularly because the schools were doing capital projects that came up somewhat suddenly. They hadn't been planned for 5 years. In some cases, an emergency like the retaining wall. In some cases, the modulars that, you know, were kicked around for a couple of years. The expertise for this is generally in town government. You know, there aren't a lot of people in the school department running around as the building inspector and the planners and public safety that know how to do with a construction project. You know, it just makes much more sense because we do this all the time in our DRTs for, you know, private contractors like Al. Do it for ourselves. It's the same people, you know, working on the relationship, and it's just easier and much more efficient to do it this way. It doesn't mean it didn't work the other way, but I will tell you it's going to work more efficiently this way. It's a lot easier to set up meetings and to have these discussions without needing to drag people, you know, from the other side of town over here. Honestly.
Well, there's not jurisdictional issues the same
and there's none
either.
Of that, and there shouldn't be.
Yeah, I mean, there really shouldn't be.
No, they're community buildings. They're not town buildings. They're not school buildings. So I think operationally this is going to work really well. One of the things I'm going to suggest to on September, I think it's 16th, we're going to have a financial forum to discuss primarily this. With the school committee, the selectmen, and the FinCom. I think one of the things I'd like to try out is we might make this whole center line accommodated costs. Let's take care of our buildings. You know, a lot of it's already accommodated its energy, but let's just not worry about that. Let's take all that right off the top and take care of our buildings. We put a lot of money into them. Let's protect them so that, you know, none of us have to make a decision about, you know, maybe we really need to cut this position out of the budget because we just can't afford it. Let's not worry about that. Let's take care of it. I'm also going to suggest, and I know the schools are amenable to this, that this line here will be voted on by the school committee. This line will be voted by selectmen.
Mm-hmm.
And this line should be voted on by both.
Yep.
It's the common cost of all the operations.
Especially if it's an accommodated cost.
Right. So you will be having a joint budget meeting at some point in January or possibly December
mm-hmm.
to put your heads together and think about this and come to some mutual
yep.
agreement on this.
A long time coming.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's a good framework. And, you know, I have to give a lot of credit. Joe tried to be as helpful as he could be while he was assistant DPW director. I don't know how easily it would be to do this without Joe. You know, he's walking back with 10 years of institutional knowledge.
Well, that's just a
step right in.
That's a happy.
Yeah, and they had a resignation, so all things just pointed out to, look, we really need to talk about this and see if it would work.
Well, the fact that you have somebody like that that allows us to initiate this with him present,
right?
You know, puts us in a great position because he's not always going to be present.
Exactly.
You know, and if you had to hire somebody to the position, the fact that you've already built it instead of trying to invent it is, this is really a big move.
And again, the change is, it's not like it's not a change. It is, but it's not operationally.
Right.
You know, he's going to go back to the job he used to have with a little more autonomy, but responsibility to report in two directions. But on a daily basis, he's dealing with all the building leaders he used to, whether they're principals or fire chiefs or police chiefs, doing the best thing for the town. And
right.
That's the way he always operated. So operationally, it's really not a change, which is nice. So a number of those items will be seen, you know, as facilities related. And this is one of the ones in the town is just upgrading this position. Where our community development director is leaving on Thursday, one of the tasks she was working on was updating a hazard mitigation plan. We're going to outsource that. I've put in $25,000. I'm not sure if it would be quite that much to hire a consultant to do the work. This is required federally with a time frame of June 30th. I don't think it's a good burden to place on her replacement. Hopefully someone will start in the next month or so.
Bob, regarding H-91, while we're talking about public services wages,
the
paint class is necessary, but I think there's an issue beyond that, and I think it's not a surprise to anyone. We have division heads who are doing the work of a division head and, in many cases, as doing their former job under the same title. Is there a long-term plan to address the fact that they're both working essentially two jobs? And
I need to tell you, there's one employee that's working four would like to have two.
Okay.
You know, it's
I feel
tough,
better already.
It's a tough issue. You know, you can see right up here, we have $55,000 that was put in the budget last year to allocate. And some of it's already spent by giving all non-union personnel an extra 0.5% COLA. So those are the numbers you see. What is not yet decided, and I just saw the first draft today, is how to spend this last $27,000. So that's going to be more individual related, and it may address some of the issues you're talking about. But you know, as you remember from the pay and class study, 55 is far away from getting everyone to median pay.
Not even, it's not even
it's
close.
A big issue. I mean, you know, there's no question we're right in the middle of the period of deciding what kind of a town do we want to be, what kind of services do we want to provide. Either we start providing below average services or less of them.
Well, you know, and a function of that is to Dan's point, you've assembled a great team who you get more than optimal performance out of, and we kind of all know that. I mean, those of us that are close to it really understand it, and I think in general people accept that as being a true statement. The retention of those people, you know, we've got to be looking longer term so that we've got the right people. Somebody gets promoted,
right?
You kind of need to replace them and have them report, you know, and that's something that, you know, we've talked about this in the past, and you know, you're not going to get that done with $27,000.
No, I don't think so.
You know, I mean, it's a bigger question.
It's a bigger question, and you're right, the quality of our employees is excellent. Turnover always causes problems. It's hard to find these same quality people en masse.
Well, it's very difficult to, you know, as you know, we've interviewed for some positions recently. And when you find somebody that might be up to that task, they run the other way because we really don't compensate. We can't offer that kind of a compensation program for them. So
there's no question it's a challenge. And money's a part of it, and I don't mean to underestimate it, but workload is another part of that.
Yes.
And we do have you know, a handful of people at the very least doing more than one person's job, and organizationally that's just foolish because when they do leave or they break down, you're not going to replace them with one.
And
person.
One of those two things is going to happen to every one of them.
Exactly.
Especially a lot of those employees that are doing that have been here for a long time, closer to retirement age, than starting age, and so you're gonna wind up having to hire two people anyway for the job, so may as well.
And HR is a reasonably good example. Our HR, long-term HR administrator, retired years ago, and before she retired, 2 years before, we talked about bringing in a new position because there's no way one person was gonna replace her, plus all the demands we saw being put on in the future, especially by the federal government. She was too busy to do that. She says, I don't have the time to split my job into two parts. I'm just gonna keep working until I drop right at the end when I retire. Now you see we're finally asking for that third position because the schools had the same issue. Their HR person quit.
Well, you finally sort out.
And you finally do sort out, okay, how do we need to divide up these jobs?
It would be so much better if we could be more proactive.
I couldn't agree more. You know, and Jesse leaving to go back to school is another opportunity for us to really look at planning because, you know, folks like Jay Ash from the Commonwealth look at us and say, you know, you have two planners, or maybe one and a half, depending on how you count your assistant town manager, and they're doing 4 to 5 people's work.
Right. Well, if you look at peer communities, they've got 3 to 5 people.
Or they don't do anything.
Or they're not doing nearly what we're doing.
So, yeah. I mean, that gets back to the question that is going to have to be raised, is who do we want to be?
Exactly.
So
there's only two solutions that I can see. Again, one is you start doing a poorer job or you do less of it, or the other is you have an override. There's just no other choice that I can see. There's not a smarter mousetrap out there.
No,
that's gonna
can't
solve
squeeze,
the whole problem.
You can't squeeze it out of a stone. If it's either there or it's not, and it's not.
Right.
And we're not going to give up the planning department. So.
No.
Reading is known for very good planning, and you know, aside from feeling good about it, you know, we've been able to fend off some 40Bs because of that. We're the only town in the Commonwealth.
And we're becoming much more attractive to quality development.
Right.
Because people are professionally handled when they come here.
Right.
Much more so.
Well, those are real life challenges that we are facing.
They are challenges, but they're hard to measure. It's more of a concept.
Yeah.
I can't show you a balance sheet that shows you what that's worth.
Yeah, you're not going to have time to do this, but at some point during this next budget process, you know, you need to develop a budget that says, okay, this is the budget of what we think we want to be or what we are.
A shadow budget.
Right. Mm-hmm. And what we want to pay people, right? And that's going to be a number that's going to like boggle the mind.
It is going to boggle you.
And then you whittle down from that budget. And that's, you know, you take your resources that are available, the resources that we think that we can garner additionally, and that becomes, you know, but that's, we need to move beyond the year by year, just like trying to, you know, jimmy this thing through one more year and just say, okay, does everybody agree that we should have a planning department that has two planners, that we want to do this for our seniors, that, you know, and that's the budget. And then, you know, and John does it on his end, and you know, and that's what we start out with. You know, obviously, maybe not all of it gets done, but that becomes the focus of discussion.
Well, if you create a model like that, and I agree with you, Barry. I think that if you don't identify the situation and the potential, you know, solutions, then we're going to just keep shoveling it against the tide year to year, and the results will. We will not be able to manage the results. You know, the results will manage the town, which is the worst thing that you could ever. In the business world, you never want that to happen.
We won't be able to catch up.
No. And, you know, I mean, you built a model, Bob, around capital a number of years ago. And that didn't mean everything was going to get done, but there was a model that said this is what ought to be done, and then you make value judgments.
And we came close.
Exactly.
To the point now we're kind of cut back on our commitment to get.
Because we can afford to.
And I think a similar approach, like the one you're talking about, Barry, is advisable. You know, it's a lot of work, though, Bob.
Well, we started it, and certainly with your help, Master Planning Health was a good step. You've seen the survey out for Human Elder Services.
Right.
So Master Planning is a good partial first step for some of the things we do. You know, I'll just tell you, in Human Elder Services, we do more than 90% of our neighbors.
Yes, that's very
clear. Is that required? No. It's Reading, though. So, you know,
take
if you
it
want
away
to,
and just see how many people start
Exactly.
Phone in.
I think one of the things that's gonna be really important is that we communicate that very fact so that people understand it.
Yeah.
I think that.
I don't think they do.
I don't think they do. I think that people are generally satisfied, but they don't really realize that the level of services is far superior to many of our neighboring communities and peer communities.
Yeah.
And I think they need to know that so that they can make a value judgment about how they want their tax dollars being spent.
Yeah, so. Last year in the budget process, I sat down and did a 3-year look ahead and did it on an FTE basis.
Right, yeah.
And I was shocked when I saw what the total was.
There was a lot more
because
in there than what
there wasn't a lot of new things in there. There was just kind of spreading out the work and making it a little more sustainable. And I think it was a 40% FTE over 3 years. I was like, we're never going to do that. And that's assuming that the pay rates were okay. Yeah, that is 50.
Right.
So you're right. The number is shocking at what this would cost. But we got to plan it. We got
to
show it.
Well, you
we, make
we have to take. It has to be exposed to the light of day
yeah, yeah.
so that it's less shocking. It needs to be a known fact.
Yeah.
So, and I think it's incumbent on us to communicate that.
And I think that'll be the basis of discussion for the October financial forum, which is FY17 budget. We need to start talking about it.
Yep.
The schools face similar issues, not identical, but we're both having hiring problems. We have on the paying class a classification chart that you approve. I think I showed John. I circled all the vacant positions or the new ones that we're going to propose. It was 21, and we just don't have a bandwidth to hire 21 people, with one HR person. It's getting
forget
hard
the money,
to hire people.
Just the bandwidth to actually get it done.
Right.
Yeah, and there's always going to be turnover. We're having a harder time hiring people, as John is, I know, on pay. Pay is only part of it, but we are starting to see it. So the warning signs are there. Anyone that would ignore the warning signs is not doing their job at this point. Just to finish this off, there you see the shared HR person right here for school and towns. We'll, again, have a location in two spots. The Board of Assessors met tonight, and they have requested $88,000, and I have all kinds of backup. Next year, a year from this fall, we're going to be in a reval. So they want to get started, and they don't want to wait for April town meeting. They did that once, and they really want to get the money now and hit it in the winter. Because of the early retirement at the state level and especially at the DOR, it's getting more challenging to do assessing work and accounting work with the state because they just have a resource problem. They're just real shorthanded. Most of their senior folks retired early. So we have to do a lot more ourselves and do it in advance. So I'm glad they asked.
When do we assess? Every 2 years?
Three.
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 Yeah. So when they do the full house walkthrough.
This will be a shock to most folks.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But
Well, it's based on last January 1st for this next one. So.
Yeah, but it's still higher than it was January.
Yeah, if we do them every 3 years.
Yeah.
Just because values go up, if they all go up together, it's no net effect on
because
it's just a proration.
Right,
because
we balance the
if my house
percent.
10% relative to yours, then my taxes will go up higher.
I was speaking to someone in development the other day, and I'll probably say the same thing. There are no new houses being built in Reading that would sell for less than $800,000, period.
No new ones?
Yeah.
Does that include
that's
affordable units?
That's the no.
I mean,
that's the smallest single-family house.
Right, just the acquisition of the lot plus.
Yep.
Market
of, well, it's the size of the house. They have no,
not a,
there's no interest in building
a 1,500
square foot.
I mean, it's a big number, but it's not shocking given what's going on in the
it's
market.
Just no,
3 to 5
just not
years
the
ago, that
do
number was 400,000.
That's why everybody's just adding on to their own houses. Now it's cheap.
Yeah. And then you can see there's some pretty big numbers in terms of this facility's transition. But the bottom line here is we're spending a net or so far a draft of $900,000, which is a lot. Some of that comes from revenues from the school department. Some of that I'm proposing that hazard mitigation come from the permits revolving fund. And then we have $700,000 from free cash. And if for some reason DOR has not certified free cash in time, which was very hard to believe, but it's possible. We may have to ask, and we may reduce the number for the general stabilization fund. Certainly could do this work also.
Bob, just on the operating side, is the library going to come in and do, I mean.
I've left a placeholder for them. We asked them to hit November town meeting, and I know I met with the consultant and gave them a real nice outline of timeline, but I should have heard by now, but I have not.
Because obviously.
It's right here. I've got staffing study, TBA.
more, yeah, obviously more FY '17 than '16, but.
It could be at this point. I asked them, you know, if there's any obvious thing that you can really bring to November town meeting, I really need to know by September 1st. So it's not over yet.
Check your email.
So there's still some time, but not much.
Bob, the S99, is that?
That's the school budget.
Is that the, doing its thing with the revolving funds or something else?
There are revolving funds as part of S99, and as part of facilities, there's a $250,000 offset from revenues they generate for rental of buildings. So it's that offset, that $250,000 that Sharon and Martha are both working on to say how much of it stays under that school department line because it's related to custodians.
Okay.
And how much of it moves to the center because it's energy or some other things. So there's kind of a lot going on, and I'm going to certainly have to do a piecemeal explanation and not do it this way at the town meeting. Well, you know, we'll pick out a couple of the parts, go through them, and then, you know, it'll make a little more sense. I'm a little disappointed there's so much capital to do, but I'm also, I know we turned back money last year from capital we couldn't do, so I think our free cash number is going to be pretty strong.
Mm-hmm.
And there will be some work done in some of the enterprise funds. I'm just seeing if I put it in here. Right here in sewer. Again, we had a capital project last year for $825,000-ish. We spent some of that in engineering work, bid out the job, couldn't get the work done. Again, not sufficient funding. So we still have $782,000, or we did have, that was turned back to reserves for sewer. So we're going to come to November town meeting and ask for $1,000,002. You know, that should be enough of a cushion for what we bid last time. And again, it was the same type of idea as with the field work. It's just, you know, if it happened all the time, I'd say it's our fault. We did a bad job estimating, but this is pretty rare. Our engineers do a pretty good job estimating capital costs.
What's a SCADA, the CADA?
There's a piece of software for all of our sewer stations we'd buy up front, one piece. And it would help do the, I think we have 10 sewer stations we're going to do over the next 10 or 12 years. So that's around 80 grand of the $1,000,002, and then the rest is just the two sewer stations, Batchelder and West. As we get into the budget discussion for FY 17, I'm pretty likely to suggest that we slow down some of our capital spending in water and sewer. First of all, no one can drive around town.
Right.
We don't have enough police detail
I'm
officers.
Getting calls from former selectmen.
Yeah, exactly. I got the same one. There's no magic about doing you know, any of this capital in 10 years instead of 15. You know, we can do it. So that'll be a discussion we'll have. You know, we'll talk about the pluses and minuses. But this will hit November town meeting. And again, maybe 400,000 of this is new money. The reserves, the last I saw, were over 2 million. It's not a big problem. But we certainly have to recalibrate our future capital plans based on how bids came in last year, which is another reason to slow it down, I think.
I know the answer to this. But is there any way to bundle these projects to go out to bid so that instead of, you know, it encompasses, instead of one thing, two or three things, it's a bigger number, it becomes more enticing.
Instead of three projects, you put it out as...
Certainly with
three pieces of one project.
Right.
With sewer stations, that'd be easy because we have 10 to do. We could bid them all out. But what I'm told is the capacity to do this work is not going to do 10. You can maybe do two, which is what we've packaged. Because we could do 10 and debt finance it, you know, and just get the work done over 3 years, let's say. But I guess as a practical matter, there's just not the volume of construction expertise out there that could do that. And that would just drive up the cost if you actually put that much work out. So, two sewer stations in a couple of years is probably about right. But, you know, certainly if there was something we could put together with Killam.
But Killam and something else.
Yeah, we're starting to think like that. But
bigger, it makes it more enticing for someone to want to bid.
We might want to do a little more of that with roads. And again, whether we start discussing doing more work in-house versus out-house, you know, that's another... You want to go hire another 10 DPW workers and do more capital work in-house, we could. It's a whole nother discussion, though.
And that's also your equipment wears down faster.
Absolutely. So So that's a preview. You can see that, you know, we will spend much more time than usual on finance, but the good thing is, once this facilities thing is described and understood, I don't think it's going to be an issue going forward. It should just work smoothly. So that's all I have for the town meeting discussion.
Very good. Okay. All right, we're on to, my goodness, 2 minutes past 8:45. That's pretty good. Item 5E, Board of Selectmen Communication Policy. I'd like to structure sort of an open discussion around three issues. Board of Selectmen communications by email, participation in social media by members of the board, and also taking positions on pending state legislation. What sorts of policies should we enact in that area? The first one is email. Everybody on the board is familiar with the open meeting law that unless we're in a posted meeting with a quorum, the board is not able legally to debate. And a debate is anytime there's an exchange, you know, reply to all on an email when we're all on distribution, whatever quorum is, you know, meaning three or more. So we always try to limit that. It's always appropriate to send information to Bob and me, because that only involves two selectmen, and you're never going to run into trouble that way. If information needs to be sent to the board, the safest way is to send it to Bob and ask him to distribute. Would you agree with that?
Yes.
Yeah. I think we've been pretty good. There's only been a couple instances where we just maybe transgressed the boundary slightly, but I don't think there's been any deliberations that I've seen.
It's more when people email us.
Yes.
So, yeah. You know, on the, for just as an example, on the...
What you were
what
you just did with the leak, the gas leaks, that was very appropriate because you contacted a sub-quorum of both your board and the climate control and just laid out the parameters we'd be reviewing that request
on. Sometimes, like on the Timberneck, on the gun safety thing,
yeah.
You know, 7-8 people email the board of selectmen.
Right.
And so, or a subset of people might, instead of just emailing the board of selectmen, the same person might email John Halsey, Dan Hensinger.
Yeah,
yeah,
you got to watch.
We don't know.
Serial communications.
We
also
don't
not
know
allowed.
If
right.
They've also done that
right.
To everybody else. And so, you know, the tendency is to want you want to reply to someone in a timely
right.
way, so that you know, even if you don't have an answer, just say, well, thank you for you know, the board will deliberate on this.
Mm-hmm.
But you don't know if they're emailing you separately.
Right.
And so by not replying, you know. Sometimes no response is worse than giving
well,
them a response that they don't like.
Bob will sometimes
but
pick up, maybe we could have a rule that the liaison to that particular area, if they can like self-identify on the spot, could reply to that and reply to the chair and Bob maybe, so at least we know it's been responded. Does that make sense?
That's what I generally try to do. If,
yeah.
if it's not clear what selectmen should be involved, I do chair, vice chair.
Yeah.
If it's clearly an issue that should be a liaison, or for instance, the firearm, there's two of you on
yeah.
it, then I pick whatever two is most sensible. But the other three don't always know that.
Yeah.
And that's
right.
the tricky part. And in some cases, I don't even know that any one of the other three has.
Because
right.
if they
involved.
Only did it to the selectmen, you may not even
I may
be
not
looped
even
into
know.
That.
Right.
So one of the things that I have done, when I understand your point, Barry, about when people write to us, they want an answer.
Well, they want to know that you at least
they want an acknowledgement that you've received
right.
it and
yeah.
that you hear their issue.
Exactly.
So what I have tried to do is respond to them and copy Bob so that Bob can then make a decision to redistribute, you know.
And are you under the selectmen's general distribution?
When an email goes to the selectmen, there's six, five
and
of you and myself.
Oh, so you do
so get I get the
oh,
ones
get
that
some.
Are
yeah,
selectmen.
So, so for example, what I have done in the interest of letting people know that they are heard, particularly if it's something that you know I'm either liaison to or directly involved with. I mean, I have responded to them, and maybe this is the wrong way to do it, but I'm just saying out loud what I have done. A one-person response, but always copied Bob, or Bob and the chair. And that way, you know, the real spokespeople
mm-hmm.
for us are those two. And
so that's kind of what I've done in the past. I don't know if that's a good policy, bad policy, but it struck me as not being in violation of the open meeting law, number one, and it gave the opportunity for what I was being, what I was saying, to at least be in the hands of, you know, those people who speak on our behalf.
You know, if you go back in time, and Dan, you could think of your prior term, the general response was, thank you very much, the selectmen will take this up at the next meeting. And that was fine 20 years ago, 10 years ago. It's not fine today. So, you know, when I started here, that was the chair's choice, was, you know, say to Peter, this is your canned answer. Thank you very much. At the next meeting, which is this day, the board will bring it up. Yesterday or a couple days ago, you had the request from the two women on the early opening permit.
Right.
Yeah.
The answer was not going to be for me, hey, it'll be discussed at the next meeting. I had to tell them a lot more. So I copied the chair and the vice chair.
Yeah. We
but the
we
other three would know.
Did you even get that?
Yeah.
Oh, you did?
Because it went to the selectmen.
Oh,
okay.
When they do the whole selectmen thing,
he gets
always...
Sometimes I've been forwarding things to you, not thinking
you,
you may not get it. But
yeah,
I'm
and it depends how it came in. There's no easy...
Somebody picks off our personal email address separate.
That's harder.
Then that's different, you know.
That's so
a lot of people may
sometimes
have
I
your address
those.
Or my
right.
any of our addresses,
right.
And they respond right. to us, or they communicate to us that way.
But I think an important thing to keep in mind is, I think... And I know Barry will agree. I think you have an obligation to give more of a response now faster than ever before. But you don't want to have immediate full response because if you need to deliberate, then you need to deliberate in a quorum.
Well, there's another issue, too, that comes in now that we have an ombudsman. I mean, we don't want to appear we're passing the buck, but there maybe are some issues that Matt can more efficiently handle.
Absolutely.
Maybe he should be his thing should
we
get
thought about
to the
adding him to the
selectmen's
distribution list.
Yeah, that'll drive
I don't
crazy.
Want to be mean to him yet, but
that's actually probably a pretty good idea.
It might not be a bad thing if that's how most people are contacting us. Then
he's mostly handling phone calls, I would say.
How would you recommend a protocol for when someone dives in from the? I mean, I'm always reading these things and saying, "All right, is Bob? I think Bob's got this."
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe that's what we need.
I think generally speaking, the chair should be involved in every reply unless there's a reason the chair shouldn't be.
That's fine.
And if it's Matt and I, we'll make sure to always include each other and the chair so everybody knows who's on it.
So anyone else can always feel free to send comments directly to Bob, but only to Bob. Bob and I wouldn't hurt, but certainly to Bob.
And if there's, again, an obvious second selectman, I think I'd much rather have two selectmen involved at all times because I'm the same situation. I don't know if you've just seen my answer.
So I think
there's
that
two
if
you
send it to the chair.
So the chair and
the
vice
chair,
or the chair and a liaison, or the chair and...
But when a member is sending, it should only be the chair and you, because they're one of the two.
Yeah, so if Kevin sends something to the two of us, because we're the chair, now all of a sudden we've quorumed up here, you know.
If we've responded.
I mean, we can't really react to that. So that's kind of why my choice was the two of you.
Actually, Kevin should respond to it. He's a secretary.
Yeah, your time will come.
So there's not many issues where more than one of you really needs to reply, if you really think about it. But there are some where all five of you might have different answers.
Yeah.
And that's going to be the tougher one to sort of police. Because
that's the one that
that's the one that really needs to go to
meeting.
That's
a deliberation item. And, you know, thank you. We hear you. And this will be up on a few, you know. We'll let you know when that meeting is.
Yeah, what the board is allowed to discuss as a quorum online is logistics, such as can you meet on October 1st?
Right.
Not really supposed to get into agenda items, but a list of agenda items is not harmful as long as it's not a discussion. But logistics, setting calendar, and kind of basic questions are fine.
Yeah, I would ask every member, take a look at that section at the beginning of our the stuff Bob sends out in the packet. That's our upcoming agendas. If there's something you feel is not there that should be there, a timely response to Bob is always welcome and to me.
Yeah.
So that's our early, that's the canary in the coal mine, if you will, of what's coming. And if there's something missing, like the Birch Meadow hearing was something that John asked me about.
Okay,
is that anything else we need to kick around on that one? Good. All right, social media. I'm a big free speech guy, and I love social media. Here's one potential pitfall I thought of. Okay, the board
anytime we post, there's a presumption that we're not only expressing our opinion, possibly a position of the board. If there's a, here's a situation that's come up. As you know, we appoint a lot of the regulatory boards, all of them, in fact, that issue permits, CPDC, ZBA, the two historical groups. A group like 01867 exists primarily to oppose a particular issue before two of the groups we appoint. My concern is if a member of this board posts on that group's site, it could create a presumption of support. I don't agree that it is support necessarily, because sometimes it's very content neutral, it's not opinionated. So I just want to throw that out there, saying should we have a policy where we refrain from doing that kind of posting on those kinds of sites as members of the board. Just like to hear your thoughts. Yes.
I can tell you, among other towns and cities, the response is a very wide variance of opinion on that.
No, I'm sure they would. Yeah.
All the way from a blackout
yeah.
to do whatever you want.
Hmm.
You know, you're a person.
Well, that's not particularly
right.
helpful.
You know, the common theme is, even though it's a small town and people are going to know, don't say you're a selectman. You know, just say, I'm Dan Ensminger and I'm answering the questionnaire.
Oh, they're going to know who you are. Come on.
Yeah, but as long as you don't say that, some communities believe that's
yeah.
enough. In other words, there's no law here. It's perception.
I agree.
Right.
It's how you want to conduct yourself.
As long as we don't give the impression that we're applying as the board.
Hmm.
You know, I mean, that's how people communicate now. In fact, so being involved in social media is an important, I mean, I think is important for us to kind of, just as selectmen, you know, keep our ear to the ground on what people are saying. But as long as we're, you know, if we go and say, you know, making it really, really clear that you're answering for yourself, I don't see it being a huge problem. Some people might always consider it a problem, but I mean, I think it's an important part of how we communicate to the community and vice versa.
Was it more important to be a lurker or be a poster as a selectman? If you're using it to keep your ear to the ground, I have no problem with that. I mean, that's just common sense. Bob?
I think you may also want to differentiate between material that might be executive session.
Oh, certainly.
Oh.
That goes without saying.
Yeah.
Or secret, top secret, confidential.
Yeah, exactly.
Top secret, compartmentalized, no foreign. I've been down that road. I don't sense there's been any real abuse here. Don't take it the wrong way. I just don't want it to create a perception, especially to the people we appoint, that this selectman is posting on this site. Am I being kind of directed as to how I should do things here? Maybe I'm being paranoid. I don't know. Am I?
How do you feel about people you appoint doing that?
Well, if it's their board in question,
well,
no way. They shouldn't be doing it.
So, you know, we probably shouldn't
no
get
member
into the...
of those historical groups should be posting on either a site pro or...
We might want to investigate social media policy for volunteers.
I think, yeah, in general.
Yourselves.
Including us, yeah.
Yeah,
I don't want to single us out, but.
Yeah. Okay.
Well, whatever it would be for us, it seems to me that it would have to be a parallel policy to all those people that we appoint. I mean, those are all committees that are advisory committees to us, and we appoint them. And whatever standards we set for ourselves are the standards that they should be operating under because they become an extension of this board, actually. I mean, that's kind of their sole purpose, really, is to work in the various areas as an advisory group to us that we appoint. So whatever we agree on for ourselves is what they need to do as well, I think. That's just my opinion.
When you're a public, you go ahead.
Does the school committee have a policy as far as
I was thinking about that. They seem to have a policy for everything. I've not heard social media discussed.
This is kind of at the vanguard of the...
Yeah, it's an interesting...
Yeah.
I
just
add
this to my points here. I said,
yeah.
Well, I should throw that one in. I mean, it could be a very two-edged sort public... social media for a public official, very two-edged sword, because no, you could be career-ending if you do the wrong thing, you know, as we all know. Yeah, one bad tweet or one bad comment, unless you're Don Trump.
Stay off of Twitter.
Stay off of Twitter, yeah, is gonna get you.
The MMA has obviously addressed this topic, maybe
Do they have any model
Five to 7 years ago, yeah, was a big hot topic about town, yeah, managers and town administrators,
right,
have a blog, have a two-way blog and all this.
Mm.
And I know from a meeting we went to down near the Cape, there was a selectman in one of the communities that had to move because of use of social media, had to move out of state.
Because of people being...
Because they were harassed.
Vicious and irresponsible.
Unbelievably,
yeah,
vicious. The story was appalling.
They were vicious to him?
Oh,
he was
the select woman,
oh,
was,
yeah,
viciously attacked by in verbally.
Yeah, that's
and
the
then actually
big downside.
Stalked because of her position on things that were expressed through social media. And you know, you're opening a can of worms that you,
yeah,
don't need to open.
Some people just lose all propriety when
you
they
know,
post.
You when there's,
yeah,
anonymity online,
yeah,
you're just it's a
the
very
rules
dangerous
are thrown
thing,
away. Some people,
right,
just they
you know,
become
a person comes
vicious.
In here would never behave, yeah, that way as they can anonymously.
Right.
So what, you know, what Peter and I discussed for a couple of years is, this is not something we want to be on the leading edge of. Let's watch it. Let's see how it behaviorally plays out.
All right.
And unilaterally, town managers and mayors pulled back because the two-way was a really bad idea because of the anonymous,
right,
part. You remember when Patch first came here?
Oh,
yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
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 And they quickly said anonymous is not working.
Yeah, but they still do. I mean, it was still.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The anonymous portion of what was going on there was,
right, yeah,
ridiculous.
If you can't, you know, if you don't want to put your name to,
well,
it, but you should.
There used to be a thing called board moderators, and you have the message boards,
right,
and that sort of kept,
yeah,
things, but now it's the wild, wild west, I think. Yeah.
Here's
go
a
ahead.
Thought.
Hmm.
Is it possible for us to create our own Facebook page?
Sure.
Reading,
yeah,
Board of Selectmen.
Sure.
And then, you know, invite everybody in Reading to like it or hate it or follow
that.
It follow it and then, you know, it's a way for us to communicate, you know, things that the board has done, not Dan or Barry or Kevin or John, but just, you know,
well, you have to watch it there that we don't get into serial. No, that's a gray area under the open meeting law, like if
yeah,
somebody
yeah,
puts
is.
Up a prep up, I think we should have second water meters and we all start.
No, but it's just we'll have an administrator or somebody, and this is one person,
mm-hmm,
responds.
Oh, I should.
To, you know, I mean, it's just
I
a
think,
way to maybe
I
communicate
think the,
things. And
maybe if sure. someone who's better at Facebook can answer this, but I think there's a way to make it that even though you like it, you can't comment on it.
Right.
Yeah, there is.
So, in other words, it's more of a bulletin board for
right.
us. There's no two-way because you can like it.
It'd be a great sounding board.
But you can't actually comment
pop,
on
the box
it.
Pop.
You follow it or something.
Yeah.
You know,
right.
Yeah.
So there's no ability for them to chime in. Oh, that was the worst thing I think you've ever
yeah.
done.
Right.
Well, actually, it might not be a bad thing.
Well,
yeah.
but then it does bring into a discussion now
right.
into play with the five of us.
Right. I think
that's a longer-term thought.
Probably. The idea of that would be, I think we'd be handcuffed because now you have five people trying to share a site with disparate thoughts, you know, of course. I mean, because we're five individuals. And, you know, there are no church mice, you know, that sit up here anyway.
Yeah.
So everybody's kind of got an opinion. And I just think that could get explosive and
yeah.
not in a good way.
That
I
seems
mean,
like
I understand the idea of hearing you know, what's on people's mind. But I just think it opens the door for some, you know, some unintended consequences that
well,
could
you
be
could,
catastrophic.
You know, you could make that as part of more of the Town of Reading Facebook page, not necessarily the selectmen. You know, we talk all the time about, we don't
we,
discuss
we,
our
there
achievements.
There is a Facebook page like that.
There is?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah,
because
so
I've actually
I say
I
that
like,
with a,
I
say
follow
that with
it.
A smile.
Do you know who started
I've never been
it?
On it.
What?
Do you know who started it?
No.
Kids in high school.
Did they really?
Yeah, Matt knows.
Is it a Reading page?
Kids in the high school started it.
Yeah.
A girl in particular.
Is
know,
it,
she
is
wants
it?
To be an intern. We've discussed that. She's
so
good.
It's not necessarily school focused. It's all issues surrounding the town.
It's
yeah,
pretty innocuous.
Not all issues, but Reading
yeah,
Reading
yeah.
issues generally. But
yeah.
That's another part is you don't always know who this is. It says
yeah.
down in Reading.
Yeah.
Hmm.
So I think think, you know, a discussion with Matt, maybe I'll bring him in some night and we'll spend
an
hour
gotta
and talk
have a
about
lot of
all these.
Thinking in this area.
Yeah.
I mean, they're all good thoughts on the board here. And again, I don't think in any way email or social media have been abused in the past. You guys have been very disciplined. I commend you for that. So, but I think it's a, you know, wild, wild west out there. Really
it
have
is.
To be careful. Yeah. All right, well, to kick that around some more. Okay, then this last one just came up because of this. These two bills, H-2870 and H-2870, even before he was appointed, Mr. Zeke and Mr. D'Addario, who has been appointed, were after both Barry and me to bring this before the board to get our approval. And I couldn't think, honestly, of a precedent where we've been asked to, actually asked by a group to support the issues before the legislature. I'm not saying that's not a good thing to do from time to time. But as I said in the beginning, I don't want to have a we don't do it policy, and I don't want to have to say yes to every advocacy group that comes before us. So I'd like us all to think about some guidelines, circumstances under which this is apropos. Now, we are public works commissioners, so this strikes me as something inherently we would be interested in. So I then want to say, okay, is it a cleared area that we would want to take a position? If so, I want to hear from the two sides, or people that can represent the two sides, and then we'll decide.
You know, my general feelings on something like that would be if it's a safety concern to the residents.
Safety,
of the top,
yeah.
I think that would be a big.
That goes right
to
the top.
That we'd want to certainly weigh in on.
Yeah. Yeah. This is a little more than safety. I think it's safety and economic. And they're almost asking that everything get fixed and no charges be applied to anybody if there are any leaks and that. I don't know how doable that is, and I'd like to hear from our public works people, people that deal with this stuff.
Sure, it's very doable. Yeah. I'm sure everyone's gas bill's going to go up as well.
Well, that's, I mean, yeah, I mean, I want to hear both sides here.
The other component, I think, of the legislation is that is to prohibit the gas company from charging consumers for the leaked gas.
Right.
Because it's just so, I mean, when they brought it to my attention, I mean, I didn't realize it, and then 2 weeks later, it was a big story in the Globe.
But we charge people for leaked water.
I was just about to say, don't we do that to the water?
I mean, we,
yes, indeed, we do.
Physician, heal thyself. Yeah. You know. How doable is it? Then you start to think, well, could we seal every water pipe in town? Probably not. Not economically. And I'm not a gas expert. I don't know. I don't know how much of this is negligence. I know they've had to account for this, you know, the degree of leaks and whether they're dangerous or not for some time due to legislation that was passed before.
I don't know how the board takes a position on something like this as a board.
Okay.
I honestly
it's a fair statement.
Yeah, I mean, this issue aside, in terms of just your general thing about sort of when is it appropriate for us to, you know, to kind of...
At least to the gating factor, then we can have this discussion, pro or con.
You know, I mean, I look at sort of the relationship we have with our legislative delegation in that, you know, we ask them to do a lot of things for us.
Yeah, they're good.
Know, whether it, you know, funding for an issue or, you know, whatever. We call on them a lot. And sometimes I think it could work the other way, where they're supporting something that they need our help on.
Hmm.
And so I think regardless of the issue, if they approach us for our general support, it'd be something that we would want to listen to right off the bat. And this is how it kind of came up, is that two of our legislators are sponsors of this bill, and their feeling was is that part of the legislative strategy to get this done is to, you know, bring local to support from folks who are definitely impacted. So whether we take a position on this or not, I think if it's something that if our delegation asks us for that support, then I think it's incumbent upon.
But would you need both conditions? They have to ask us for our support. It would have to also be an issue under our purview.
I don't know, something that
I don't
want to
bring
in.
You know, let's
right.
We want to support, you know, some
right. We're going
to weigh
be,
out political
right,
cause.
Right,
it's
exactly.
Two of them are one party, one of the other.
Exactly. It has
I don't
want
to do
a
that.
Direct
yeah.
impact. You know, and in this particular
right.
case,
yeah.
the legislation that was already passed showed that there's 140 known gas leaks in
right.
the town of Reading. Now, if we had zero or two, you know, maybe not, but. But something that has a direct impact on us, residents of the town of Reading, whether a safety issue, obviously the most important, but economic also important. It's something that we get asked to to look at by our delegation, I think should be the, you know, and if there's a huge interest in people in town, you know, that should be kind of the threshold, and then we may say, you know, this isn't for us, or we do it and just
so
take not, or not take a position.
Well, do we, when we're redoing a road, do we contact gas company to see if they, you know, they want to come out and
Years
to get
advance.
An old line, and is it something they're receptive to? Is it something they just go, oh, well, we'll call the owners and see if they want to pay for
it
on the street?
They're receptive to it, but over the years, they've definitely changed. They used to be much more aggressive looking for customers and paying, if you will, the upfront costs, not so much anymore. Plus, they're busier now. I'm sure they don't have the staffing they wish they had. Invariably, something happens just after you paved a road.
Yeah.
So you do the best you can with all the utilities and say, look, other than a disaster or something that happens after the fact, do all your planning in advance. And we do generally okay with that. So they're pretty good to work with in that sense. They've got to be 2 years in advance, though, their plans. And they generally know. You know, our engineers work with them all the time, so they, you know, they give you a more detailed answer.
Right.
But they're not
so
bad. Same with the light department and, you know, Verizon, Comcast, any of them.
So in the context of this discussion, does the board agree that we ought to take this up at our next meeting? Is this, this is there a gating thing that lets us through? Yeah, John.
I have
there's no right answer.
I have a few comments about
sure.
this.
Yeah.
I mean, if there's 140 gas leaks
yeah.
in the town of Reading, then we need to get on that, and it has nothing to do with this. It has to do with we have a public safety obligation as selectmen to, if we have found this out to be true, then we have to understand what we can do to look out for the best interest in the public safety of the citizens of Reading. You know, the idea that and we should. I mean, that's, I mean, if that's a fact, then we need to approach it as a board in Reading. The idea that the delegation, we ask them for things all the time. That's their job, is to field our requests. I mean, that is a huge part of their obligation to those citizens, and we speak on behalf of many of their constituents. So, you know, the idea that it's a two-way street, I don't necessarily agree with.
Well, remember, Bob in one of his initial comments to them said, what can we do for you? And that's one of the few times anyone had.
That's fine, but I will tell you this, and I don't disagree with this philosophically as being a bad thing. Where I take issue is, as a board, it's not our job to look at legislation. Now, you know, if Jim Dwyer and the senator say to me, John Halsey, will you help me personally support this? I'd look at that and do everything I could to, you know, but as a selectman, I mean, I don't know that I don't think about this as something that's in the purview of the Board of Selectmen to act on. I think it puts us in a political light that we should not be involved in. Now, personally, you know, I have no problem. I think we happen to have legislators on Beacon Hill who really pay attention to what's going on in our town, and I'm very thankful for that. And if they ask me to do something, I try to do it if it makes any sense to me at all because of the support that they give to the town of Reading. But I don't know that I'm comfortable with, you know, an ask of the board to support legislation. I just think it's outside of our purview. Not that I think that the topic is even bad. And on the topic, if we've got 140 leaks in this town, we better get off our butts and do something about
you're
it as selectmen.
We as a board should have the gas company in, or at least talk to our public works guys and say, how do we address this? And
yeah, I mean,
how
that's
do we get
our
these
job.
Guys in?
I mean, you know, when we'd, somebody,
irrespective of whatever the legislature
correct.
Is doing.
Correct. I mean, when somebody came to us and said, hey, there's something going on in the Timberneck Swamp that we think is a public safety issue.
Yeah.
We rise to the occasion.
Right.
It's that is our job to do that. If the legislature was trying to do something about mass general law and wanted us to support it,
well, I don't see
I'm
not
that.
A lawyer.
You know,
I don't know all the implications.
So that's just kind of my thoughts on this. It's not about the topic,
mm-hmm.
and sounds like, just kind of on the very edge of it, that we may have an issue we better get hot on as a Board of Selectmen if we've got a public safety issue going on, you know, in the town of Reading. And that really, that's just kind of where I'm coming from on it. I think that everything we do should be focused inside the framework of the town of Reading. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what we're elected to do. And that's kind of where I have a comfort level. That doesn't mean I'm not interested and actively involved in stuff that's outside the town of Reading, because I am, personally. I happen to be a selectman, that's a fact. And so will that carry some weight? Probably, kind of, you know, you can't deny who you are. And we can be helpful, I think, to the legislators that are helpful to our town. But I see that as a personal issue rather than as a board issue. Just my opinion.
I think I agree with you. Yeah. Any other thoughts?
No, on this particular issue, I haven't actually read the two bills that have been passed through, so I don't have anything particular on that one. But
well, the request is from the climate advisory group, and I think that they've done a lot of research on this to the point they can educate us on the impact in Reading, so that whether or not we act on a recommendation on this particular piece of legislation.
Let's be clear about that group. They have a perspective. They're an advocacy group, I think, for one side of the equation here. I think you agreed when we sort of talked offline that it's important to get both sides, mm-hmm. The gas, utilities. I'd like to hear from our own DPW about what's doable, what's not doable. So I don't know that we would hear the most objective presentation. I'd rather hear from our own DPW, but I don't know.
Well, are we clear with them that they're not in a position to take a position as a committee?
Is this the wrong direction for the communication, I guess? Should we be not directing them to do things?
Well, they brought it to our
attention. Oh, it's fine for them to bring something up.
I guess that's all right.
I personally don't think that an advisory committee should be taking a public position that we have not blessed.
Well, they're not. They're asking us to take it.
Okay, so for them to, I have no problem with them bringing it to us. Yeah. I have no problem with it at all.
Does this deserve a spot on our next agenda? I'm just going to ask it straight out. Should we or shouldn't we?
Well, to me, it's not about the legislation. To me, it's about the public safety issue.
It would be about
the
legislation.
If we have a public safety issue here in Reading, then it requires maybe its own meeting. I'm okay with that, too, and I'm in full support of that. And if the client advisory committee on climate wants to come to us, that's their job, is to come to us and say, hey, there's something going on.
And they
you
have
guys need to, know, but we can't be everywhere doing everything. That's why all these advisory boards and committees are out there. So I'm thrilled that they bring this to our attention. I'm not so sure that we should be engaging a debate about how we support or don't support legislation. I fully support hearing from all parties about a public safety issue with the town of Reading.
Yeah, I think I'm willing to certainly pursue this from a town of Reading standpoint. Certainly we're not, the limited amount I read about this, we're not the most directly impacted community. I think Boston is in horrible shape compared to us here. I guess I would not be inclined to want to take this further at this point.
But wouldn't you want to know about how this impacts Reading?
Oh yes,
I think we got to get on our legislation.
I don't feel equipped to do that. I don't feel that's my role. But I do feel. I think you said it well. I think that was a pretty compelling thing you said.
I love to hear from all concerned in Reading, including the client advisory committee and the DPW and the town engineer and whoever else can add, can shed light on this. And the gas company.
I mean, so you would not have a problem having a future
not at all.
Agenda
I,
item
not
about
at all. I think it'd be great,
issue.
Actually.
Yeah.
I think they've done exactly what they're supposed to do.
Okay.
They've identified an issue, brought it to us.
We thank them for that.
We need to run, with that.
Yeah, I directed them also to talk to Chief Fire Chief.
Yeah, we hear from him at all?
I have not asked him.
I saw the email.
He was away last week, so that could be why.
I think they may have met, so I don't know.
Okay.
I'd like to hear the chief's.
We'll keep that dialogue going about Reading then. Why don't we just leave it at that?
Yeah, we'll discuss it internally and.
Okay.
I'll check with the chair and maybe schedule something, I'm thinking in October or November.
And I do think we've raised, you know, in a public forum here. I mean, I don't know how many people are watching tonight, but there's always people watching, we know that. So we need to be, we've now put something up, you know, you gotta follow the bouncing ball. Now, you've gotta bring something back so the people that are interested are gonna wanna know what we have found out as their elected representatives about any public safety issues in Reading.
Correct.
Surrounding this topic.
Okay, so it sounds at this point that we will not be scheduling time to take a position per se on these two issues before the legislature.
I don't wanna be, you know, the guy running this. That,
no,
I just gave
not,
you my opinion.
Well, you don't have a clear majority to proceed, I think, at this point. All right. Need to say anything more about that tonight?
Nope.
Let's move on to the town manager evaluation. Let's see, in your packets, you will find the individual, and I don't know if John Arena's made the one that's on the desk tonight. He
I think so, yeah.
He his came in over the weekend.
Yes, and there's an updated summary.
Awesome,
at the end.
Yep.
I need to
thank you very much.
Is that the one that was sent electronically, or is that?
I'll call a 5 minute break. Yeah.
John sent
5 minute
today.
Break. We'll re-adjourn at 9:30.
Is that what it is?
They seemed a couple years ago.
Well, they look like they're different chairs. I don't know if they're new.
First act of the new town.
next item of business will be the town manager evaluation for FY 2015. This year we adopted a new format that dealt with both the so-called Reading 2020 goals and the degree of attainment of those goals, and also some performance on standards, certain indicators regarding leadership and professional culture as Area 1, Area 2 being management and operations, and Area 3 being community engagement. So we developed each of the board members, their rankings and ratings for each of those. For the goal areas, there were three levels of grading. Did not meet the goal, met the goal, or exceeded the goal. And for the performance on standards, either unsatisfactory, needs improvement, proficient, or exemplary. And proficient here is defined as a practice to be understood to be fully satisfactory and the rigorous expected level of performance. Exemplary indicates that the practice significantly exceeds proficient and could serve as a model of practice regionally or statewide. And the other categories are self-explanatory. So I would like to go through the summary, Bob. I think we'll pull that up on the board.
I don't have it with John Arenas. Do you want?
That's okay. No, we'll do it anyway. Okay. I'm mostly going to focus on the overall. I'm going to try to keep this free form. If there are specific comments, or if anyone wants to make like a general statement, once we've gone through the summary here, kind of summing up some of your views, the town manager's annual performance, or if there are any specific ratings you'd like to kind of dive into and explain further, that's fine too. So I'll let you guys answer in any order you want. You can answer as many times as you want. Oh, that's still coming up?
Couple minutes.
Okay. Okay, under I'll go through the eight major goal areas. First major Reading 2020 goal, community partners, regional. Second goal, community partners, nonprofit and private. Third goal, services and performance measurement. Fourth area, communication. Fifth area, strategic planning. Sixth area, strategic real estate. Seventh area, strategic policy. And eighth area, internal operations. And there were different sub-goals in each of those areas. So the town manager received an overall rating of meets expectation on all eight of those areas using a composite of all five selectmen. There were variation within each of those. The first one was meets across the board community partners. There was one exceeded and one did not meet under community partners, nonprofit, private. And there was some variability under services and performance, but essentially town manager exceeded or met in many of the categories. There were a couple of did not meets that if anyone wants to elaborate on, they're free to do that. I had a couple questions on, I'm looking at the summary on the major goals. Barry, you had a did not meet as the summary, but I looked at your, I think we talked about this briefly before the meeting. I looked at your detailed comments, and I think that added up to more of a meets than a did not meet.
Which?
I'm looking at, this is 2020-3. If you could maybe review some of that. I had you down as on goal 9, the inventory of public services meets. Goal 10, gathering data, measuring performance, did not meet. Public health division exceeded. RICASA and emergency plan were both meets. So I thought that if you smooth those out, that was more of a meets than a did not meet.
Maybe I didn't understand.
Okay.
I think the one thing that I put down that did not meet was it the third?
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, I was just looking here.
And just to be clear, we didn't get the comments from each individual person, correct?
If they supply, they're on their individual. Okay, let me just explain that. The summary sheet is only intended to have the metrics on it. It does not have the comments except for the summary.
Right.
You would have to look on the individual file. I just don't want Paula to.
Did we? Yeah, but did we get the individual ones?
Yeah, they're in there. They're in your packet. They're all in there. Except for John's, I think.
No, 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 the individual comments.
Yes, but they're in the individual reviews, is what I'm saying.
Which we don't have.
Yes, you got them in the packet.
No, you got them. They were in the packet that was emailed.
They're in the packet?
Everyone's evaluation.
Okay, that's what, yeah, that's the question.
It is?
Yep.
Who'd that come, did that come from you or did that come from Paula?
From me.
All the packets, came from you? Okay, I'm just trying to pull it up.
The one we got electronically?
Yes.
Yes, okay.
Yeah, that'd be.
Not in here.
No, it's not in here.
And I have paper.
And that's good because you saved it for us. So.
There you go.
But I was confused thinking that something was missing out here.
So if you need to refer to that.
I did see it in the electronic copies.
Can't pull it up easily, I have a paper copy here, but I, still coming up?
No, it's right behind me, it should be, whoops.
Yep.
Yep.
Small delay. Play the music.
Oh, here I am, thanks for the packet.
I think I was, I thought my stuff was more addressing,
Here, I'll show it to you.
Just sort of the sub-goals rather than the goals in general.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
So creating.
You also used an older form, but I think it was accurate, yeah.
So goal 23.
Yeah, look on your page three, do you have it?
Let me see if I can find Barry's.
I think that's more of a.
Seemed easier to use when I was using it.
But the summary you said, goal two did not meet. I just didn't know if that was a transcription or.
Is it mine?
Yeah, that's the one you sent in. So I just don't know if you want.
No, yeah, no, this is, this is.
I'm looking under area three.
So explore, create a public-private partnerships.
Yeah.
I think that's two.
Goal 2020-3, whatever's under that, is what I'm talking about.
Services and performance measurement.
Yeah.
Oh, services and performance measurement, I mean, I know that we've done our, we've kind of put together an inventory of services.
Correct.
But I don't think we've come up, unless I'm wrong, unless this was done before I got here, sort of ways to measure them all, I think that's sort of the next step.
Yeah.
And so in that sense, I still, we still need to do a little work on that, so.
Okay, alright, so you, that was your overall, alright.
And then the other, and the same thing for explore creative public-private partnerships, we've talked about it, but we've, you know, it's just the beginning phases, so I gave it a did not meet, even though it's been talked about and discussed, not, you know, I look at that as like, well, we've done it.
Yeah.
Would be the meet or exceeded, so that's how I interpreted it.
Okay, that's fair enough.
Just to clarify that.
So I have a do not, did not meet on the communication, so let me speak to that issue.
Sure.
I think I was pretty clear about that in my individual comments, but, you know, that was really a function more of what we've talked about, as a group.
Yeah.
And individually about the goals being, you know, expanded, you know, highly communicative, discussion of many things. And I don't think we're there yet. I think it's not a question, I mean, it's not, it's really, I wouldn't characterize it as a critical statement, I would characterize it as, for me, a factual statement that we've got certain goals that we'd like to get to. And I think, you know, part of that, for example, is starting to happen because we were able to hire Matt.
Yeah.
You know,
right.
I mean, and Matt came on, you know, midstream here, I believe, in this, you know, in this cycle of goals.
Right.
So that's really where that's coming from. I think
yeah,
that,
I understood.
You know, the there's a certain starkness to that, you know, when I look at that up there, that, for me, I've never been a big fan of the grid. I'm a big fan of the, you know, of the discussion.
Yeah.
And a big fan of the comment. But at a certain point, you know, I do understand why you got to build a grid. Because what it does is this. And I just say this to you, Bob, because this is an evaluation of you. It will, for me, when I have something like that that jumps off the grid and it's the only thing like it, it causes the discussion.
Yeah.
You know, so I, you know, I accept that starkness in the grid for its value in that it, you know, creates a discussion towards, you know, working on these goals. But I'm sure you had a chance to read my commentary on these topics.
Yeah, and as I has suggested ahead of time, and I really do appreciate it, the comments are the value, with no disrespect to the scoring. It's
right.
really
yeah.
what
you
is got, the
you
observation.
You have to have scores.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, and the other thing we can all sort of learn from, I guess, to some degree, is be careful what you say the goal is. So one of the goals was board committee summit.
Right.
We never had one.
No,
had one.
We didn't.
No.
Wasn't met.
So I had to say that. I
yeah,
had
no,
to say
no,
no.
It's black and white.
Yeah, I think you were right.
And we
yeah.
could have had one, and it would have been the wrong thing to do, because first we had to fix the staff setup
correct.
In order to get the boards to communicate, in order to eventually have a useful
which is the
board
part
committee
I focused
summit.
On,
yeah, so.
I understood that, yeah, you had to do that first.
Yeah.
That's therein lies the challenge in the
exactly.
in the grid.
And the goals
exactly.
are always going to be reevaluated.
yeah.
yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I guess... under regional community partners, I was very impressed with the work that both you and Bob did on fixing the health agent issue and the
mm-hmm.
whole health thing, and probably a lot of your discussions helped formulate Bob's thinking, or maybe crystallize his thinking on how to reorganize that whole department. And I think it's been a success. I just think there's a lot of work to do there, and perhaps we need another person or two eventually. I also gave, when you refer to regionalization, I also think of intra-regionalization, and I think that's a term coined at town meeting. And the accomplishments with the school department, perhaps their late-inning developments, and some of them, not all of them, because the facilities discussion has been ongoing. But the breakthroughs on technology and HR were, I think, very meaningful and appreciated. And I took some pains to write that up under goal R2021. I think we need on community partners, nonprofit, private. We do need to move forward on certain real estate. I didn't know where exactly to put the real estate stuff. There was maybe a strategic real estate later. I should have
yeah.
put this under, but certainly the Oakland Road property is languishing, and we need to do something about that. This needs to really move forward early in the next fiscal year. Under services, performance, and measurement, that's the third R2020 goal. It's important that we see that MAPC inventory of services. I don't think we've spent a lot of time digesting it and seeing what it means to us. And we need to formulate follow-on policy with town and school departments. Regarding goal 18 on RICASA, we need to identify grant writers who apply for follow-on funding after the current grants expire. And emergency planning, due notice was taken of the successful update of the town's hazard mitigation plan. That's a good first step. Well, that'll need constant updating. There's probably other areas we need to deal with there. Okay, communication, on the board, I think we've talked about board committee summit. That's going to happen soon. Hasn't happened yet. Easy-to-use community feedback methods, that's goal 11. See, click, fix, I called out as a real success with DPW. The board and others will have to debate where we take that next and give Bob the proper guidance there. There's a number of other areas, Bob, you see, potentially. Okay.
Yeah, I think the town manager / ombudsman.
Yeah.
It's another one of those things, though, that you don't want to spend more time keeping track of what you do than doing it.
I know.
So there's a fine line in there somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if it's a pothole, DPW doesn't know there's a pothole necessarily. Someone needs to tell them. So that's a little easier to see.
Yep.
But I think the town manager's office is one of the next places. We'll just use it a little more judiciously than every single phone call or email.
Mm-hmm. And on goal 22 under communication, the examination of role of the boards and committees. I have to admit, I wasn't initially a fan of Bob spending so much time on the charter. However, when I heard some of the difficulties that group was encountering and then saw the difference that Bob's involvement made, and certainly town council helped out there, he really drove the results, such as expanding the role of associate members and expanding the committee creation powers, among a lot of other accomplishments. So I'm happy you didn't listen to me on that one. Okay, strategic planning, complete streets, great success. Barry, that might have been before you came on, but
I think so. Some of the stuff I didn't know about, I
that's okay.
I more than likely left blank.
That's all right. Yep, fair enough. It was
rated as one of the top 10 in the country and is ready for 100% grant funding. I think our work toward 10% affordable housing may never quite be met. However, our housing production plan is complete under Bob's leadership. And town staff, I think, have done the best they can. They've built excellent working relationships with the 40B people at the state level and have always filed timely responses to mitigate 40B development impacts. I'm hoping, without giving any explicit guidance, that our ZBA will take a careful look at the 40B project proposed for Prescott and Lincoln and see if there's any ways that can be improved that'll pass muster. Okay, strategic real estate, some great first steps made with MAPC, but I think the town should directly negotiate, and maybe these negotiations have started with all property owners who are interested in redeveloping, especially their industrially zoned properties. I know one property owner, Bob, you know who I'm talking about, probably wants to do that, so I don't think we need to wait for the MAPC to show us what to do there, although their guidance is certainly appreciated. Goal 28, which is under strategic real estate, review recreation facilities. There are a number of opportunities that have started there and others that are coming to fruition in the revised Birch Meadow Master Plan. There was great leadership on getting the lights done, and I've been told by a longtime town meeting member they've been in the master plan since the 1930s, so it's about time.
Well, I think
time.
I know who that
yeah,
is.
you know it is. And a big shout out on goal number 30, the library building project. Bob exerted a lot of leadership at the very outset of that process, and I think wrested control of it, if I could say. In a good way, and it's now under experience management. He's really leveraged Joe's abilities. He's retained him as an employee here, and Joe certainly helped Bob in performing yeoman service regarding that project. In terms of strategic policy, I gave Bob a pass on the selectmen's policies, even though, because in fact the board agreed that goal should take a back seat to other higher priority initiatives, so I did not mark him down on that. I've already mentioned Bob's involvement in the town charter and zoning bylaw. The zoning bylaw, I think, is he had a lot of good political acumen about how many town meetings to spread that out over to decide how much was just enough for each town meeting. And it looks like it's been a successful move so far. Goal 24, I guess, we haven't really discussed the CPA as a board. My own view on it, take it for what it's worth, is the time for adopting the CPA in Reading has come and gone. There's too much red tape and too little reward in the way of state reimbursement. It's another tax. Do we really want to be burdening people with another tax at a time we're contemplating overrides? It's a very limited beneficiary set. You know, it's, you know, buying up open space and potential.
You have a question?
Yes,
that.
Go ahead.
I just had a comment. You didn't spend a lot of time discussing this,
no.
Certainly not as a board. It was discussed at a financial forum last fall with the same conclusion.
I know. Well, there's some people that liked it a lot. There are a lot of red dots it got. But
yeah, but yeah. The FinCom as a whole agreed that
oh,
it was
did.
Not a priority
okay.
over and over again, just to be clear.
Okay. Permanent Building Committee, I don't think Bob should be marked down on that because the reason we didn't fill it was pretty much a lack of appropriate applicants with the requisite disparate backgrounds that we were looking for. That's really what held it up.
I just can I
yeah. sure.
I'd put it down as it did not meet, just because
yep.
I think that, you know, part of what we do is we go out and we shake the bushes to try to find people to do the things
yep.
we want to get done.
Yep.
So
fair enough.
I still think it's a given all the things that we're going to now do to reconfigure facilities, the creation of this committee becomes more important than ever. And I just put it out there as it should be a top priority of getting that filled.
It's funny, I had the same comment, but I put a met next to
right.
it and wrote the comment of, you know, better marketing of
yeah.
for these volunteers
right.
is absolutely
right.
needed.
Yeah.
What do we have now, Paula? 7 applicants?
Yes.
So we got
oh,
3
good.
More recently.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Okay.
Some good ones.
Let's get on it. All right, my final comment on goals, area R 2020-8, Internal Operations. Goal number one, Bob has really done an outstanding job there. Hiring of Matt Cornelis as Administrative Services Director was the capstone on what I termed Bob's expert restructuring of town government. Our departments now all have successors in place who can ably back up their department heads in the absence of absence, retirement, or emergency. And I think that's going to bear fruit in the future in certain areas. Under comprehensive review of library services, goal 12, I called out specifically the board, and Barry, I don't know if you've been around for this discussion, but the Historical Commission has a number of very sensitive artifacts that probably should be under better temperature and climate control. They're sitting in the basement of this building and don't have a place to go to. Heretofore, and maybe this is changing, the Library Board of Trustees has been a little indisposed to taking on those.
I spoke to the library director. I
think that's changing.
It's going to change.
Excellent.
Yeah, that's good.
Good. Okay. And goal 33, long-term liability planning. Reading continues to be a lead community in the paying down of OPEB liabilities and others. So I've taken way too long to talk here. Anybody else want to chime in on goals, and then we can move on to the other part.
I just like to ask Bob's take on all the reviews here. I assume now you've had a chance to kind of go through it all and what you found helpful.
Well, sticking with the goals, you know, there was however many, 30 or 40 individual goals, and they were grouped somewhat randomly into groups. I think it was pretty hard to look at that first page with eight different Reading 2020 groups because they range from 1 to 10 goals as sub-goals.
They do,
right.
So that was kind of a hard exercise to really come up with a meaningful summary, I would think, for you.
Yes.
Whereas doing the individual goals is a lot simpler.
The individual
was
really
bad,
easy.
Not so.
Well, it was interesting to see if they actually tied out.
Yeah.
So if you did this,
do that.
And you did that.
I assume they did.
And then you went back and looked at like, did it make any sense
two plus
what
two
we did in
the
five
a couple times for you?
Just so you know, Arena's was right in the smack in the middle of everything. He didn't change any of the ratings. So.
Okay, yeah. So other than that, I thought this was a really useful exercise. But, you know, again, we've done the goals in the past, and it's really helpful. It's interesting to see the different interpretations among five people that generally get along well and see eye to eye on most things. Mm. So it is interesting that you don't always agree on how to score something.
It was interesting to see did not meet with a
exceeded. Exceed, yeah.
Yeah.
And I was looking at it as like, you know, is someone just an easy grader? Well, one of them kind of. But there's cases where that's reversed.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's interesting. And I'm not sure what the message is other than it's nice to have different opinions.
Yeah.
That's what makes the community. And again, my overall comment is I think your written words are really what's meaningful.
And
I
the format, I think,
it.
I hope was an improvement over last year.
Yeah, it was.
The format actually is pretty good. When you think about all the things that you've got to try to condense into a form, it's pretty good.
Well, talking about the goals, I think the rest of it is fantastic. The goals is just as good as it was last year, maybe a little bit better.
Yeah.
I think the rest of it's great.
Good.
You know, I think, again, I appreciate the fact that it took a lot more effort on your part to do more than goals. Evaluations. That's really, as I was reading through it, I was like, this is really the most valuable stuff here. Because we may not perfectly agree on how a goal was accomplished, but we all have a general idea.
Yeah.
But the other opinions, you know, it's not something we talk about at meetings. It's not tangible. You know, it's your personal opinion on things. You know, I thought that was very helpful.
If everything's an E, then there's nothing to shoot for
next year. No, it can't
be an E.
Yeah.
I actually do think that the grid is something that can create provocative discussion.
That's all it's for.
I mean, honestly, I don't know that it's got a real value. I mean, it's got a value to do that,
right,
in my mind. Beyond that,
I'm kind of with you.
Yeah.
I mean, it's
you kind of have to do the exercise to create the conversation.
That's I think that's exactly what helped me come up with the comments was going through, you know, the grid part of it and looking at it and really thinking about it a little bit deeper to come up with a comment as to why I felt this mark was deserved or not.
Whereas this section down here, you don't see
so as much
a difference of opinion on the same question.
Mm.
You know, there's much more consistency for whatever that's worth.
Well, also, some of those things are, some of those are a little bit motherhood, some of those statements, so, and how do you measure them?
Right.
Is really not given, so, much more subject to.
Yeah, and I assume if the results were really bad, there'd be no reason I'd still be sitting here. Just looking to see any other comments. If you look on, well, let me find it. I thought this section was also helpful.
Mm-hmm.
1A, 1B, so it, you know, it sums up to that other page, standard one, leadership and professional culture, and that's a good summary. But, you know, for the goals, the way I would have done it is I had scored the individual goals and then I have built it up whatever the average was. I don't know how you did this. You probably did it the same.
It's a preponderance of scores, mainly.
But to me, these aren't something I would have known because they're a goal we discussed.
Mm-hmm.
So your opinions
exactly.
here were more valuable, honestly, than on goals because they were
because you didn't even know we were going to evaluate you.
No idea.
No.
Yeah, no idea. So, you know, these were all interesting, and they're similar with sections two
right.
and three.
Anything, any shocks for you? Anything that made you really scratch
positive
your head?
Or negative?
Anything
you
don't agree with?
Thinking?
Yeah.
What I did was I wrote down how many goals for the top one, you know, how many were under each. And then I wrote for the individual goals what I had told you was a percentage of completion.
Yeah, I saw
that. I was surprised that a couple that I said were 100 that were do not met.
Yeah, I was
that depends on scope. What did you really think?
Well, that's one
was?
Reason I sent out our July
yeah.
minutes because that
right.
had Bob's sort of self-review.
That was
there.
Helpful, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So goal nine, create only because it's the first one I see. Create an inventory of public services provided. I said 100. John Halsey said did not meet.
Right.
And I understand why you said that.
Mm-hmm.
Technically, the goal was done.
I know.
But the real goal wasn't complete.
And that's why I went
right.
there.
I know.
I
know. And you're right.
We've talked about this, and
right.
you know, I felt that the spirit, and so it made me want to have a conversation with you, so that I put it there.
I know.
And
so
on this
some
one,
instances, maybe the question was wrong.
Well, the question was maybe.
I think, again, the point is to have the discussion, not
yeah.
so much that it's an A, B, or a C.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. Which is why I put did not meet in terms of creating the evaluation of it. I mean, basically, it's like, okay, first we have to see what we have,
yeah.
and now we have to, you know, sort of figure out how we're going to collect the data to evaluate it. So that's why I put the
it's a matter of
on
expectation.
That part of it.
How much did you expect
right.
to be completed under that goal in this particular?
And on the other side, review public works facilities was one of the lowest scores that I had reported as 25%. And John Halsey said excellent.
Yeah.
So,
well,
you know,
you know, and that's tied to things that I know
you
pay attention to.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's very interesting. I
it
mean,
is.
I've had over a lifetime career, really, where human resources was part of my job. The exercise of review yourself, I'll review you, we'll swap,
yeah.
and then we sit down for 2 hours.
Yes.
Yeah.
And, you know, and to take the opportunity to for clarification, for thought-provoking discussion, for where do we go with goals from there. I mean, that's been, over many years, that's kind of an exercise that I found to be highly productive towards next year.
Yeah.
No matter what. Even if that was to reroute somebody's career. I mean, honestly, because, it, you know, what it did is it created a healthy environment of communication.
So surprises in that sense that I starkly differed from some of you on some of them, but when I read your explanation, then I understood. But at first, it was like, what? How did I do really well at something we hardly did any, you know, accomplished any real final goal on? Okay, now I understand. And likewise, wait, we finished this. Oh no, you didn't. Your initial, you know, question wasn't the full question. So I think the point all of us have learned is it's the discussion that follows. That's the meaningful part, and not the optics of what this looks like. But I thought it was really useful.
Right.
And again, I'm really glad you went beyond just the goals discussion.
Well, if I could sum up, and I think I speak for the board, Bob, your
We're very happy to have you aboard here. You certainly are proficient in many areas and exemplary in a number of them.
Thank you.
And we feel we have a very steady hand at the helm of a very creative person as our town manager.
I appreciate that.
And we hope to have many more years of your service.
We're kind of asking for a raise.
You want money too? He has all the glory.
Yeah. We could share that.
Any other comments anyone would like to add?
Actually,
the
only thing that I would, I just second all of Dan's comments. The one thing that I would like to see you do more is get out there and tell our story.
Yeah.
And I because I think there's so much of what we're doing that we really talk great amongst ourselves and amongst, you know, committees. And what I just put in there, it's like, I would love to see you get, you know, ask the manager.
The town, yeah.
Get on that again, or you know, a monthly article in the Chronicle or the Advocate, just, you know, picking a topic. I mean, believe me, the news comes fast and furious when we mess up. But you know, I just think that we're just so used to doing so much and doing it well, it becomes taken for granted, and the story doesn't get told. And I just think, I'm not a marketing genius, but you know, I just think it would be great to see you out there more doing some of that.
And likewise, I could be sitting here at the town manager's report and give you a list of five things that the town accomplished various departments since we last met. You'll know about some of them through the media and from other reasons, but you won't know about all of them, and I don't do that because it takes a lot of time and effort to gather all that. And I think your point is well made that how do you expect the residents to know if we're not telling them in an organized fashion? And Matt and I have talked about that. So.
That's one of the reasons I wanted to take the state of the town the way I did this year. And you
made
a number
good.
Of great comments about the unsung heroes in this town. You know, the folks in the finance department, the folks in administrative services, and they didn't get left out as a result of that.
Right.
So that's,
we'll
have to find more ways to do that as a joint effort.
Yeah, we all, pretty much every department head recognizes we don't do marketing very well. Sometimes it's part of the job, library, senior center, you know, it's more part of the job. But if it's not part of the job, we really just don't do it.
All right, anything else need to be said tonight? We have minutes from August 11th. Is there a motion?
I believe there is. Move the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of August 11th. 2015 as amended.
Is there a second? I'll know, speak at once.
I wasn't either.
Oh, okay. Why do we defer?
Defer.
Well, you can
Let's
vote
defer.
Even if you weren't there if you want to.
Okay, rule of necessity, I'm invoking it. You can both vote. All in favor? Okay. Opposed, abstaining?
Get us to at least
abstaining.
I'll call that 301. And now we have need a motion to go into executive session.
So moved.
Well, not yet. We got to read it. And we got to, whoops, where'd it go?
You have to do it individually.
Hold on.
Yeah, we do.
Don't go anywhere.
There's forms that need to be signed.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Move to go into executive session to discuss strategy with respect to litigation, Sutton Brook, and that the chair declares that an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the bargaining position of the body, and will not reconvene in open session.
Is that seconded?
Second.
Mr. Herman seconds. I'll poll the board. Mr. Halsey?
Yes, I agree.
Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Mr. Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Ensminger? Yes. We stand adjourned from open session.